Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Campaign of Giants, The Battle for Petersburg, Volume 1, From the Crossing of the James to the Crater, by A. Wilson Greene. Foreword by Gary W. Gallagher. Narrated by Paul Woodson. Foreword. The Petersburg Campaign extended from the early summer of 1864 into the spring of 1865. By far the longest and most complex military operation of the Civil War, it featured each side's most famous and accomplished general, produced scores of thousands of casualties, closed with the premier Confederate army in full retreat and the rebel capital under Union control, and set up the climactic surrender at Appomattox just a week later. Most often treated as an example of two armies locked in a grinding siege, some authors argue that it anticipated the stalemate on the Western Front in World War I. The campaign, in fact, featured complex maneuvering and a number of individual battles, as well as the creation of the most sophisticated systems of fieldworks and fortifications to that point in United States history. Among all major operations of the Civil War, only Petersburg has lacked a modern, comprehensive scholarly study. Indeed, campaigns such as Antietam, Vicksburg, Shiloh, Chickamauga, Atlanta, and Chancellorsville continue to inspire numerous expansive treatments, never mind Gettysburg, which has spawned a literature of several thousand items that offers detailed discussions of almost every phase of the fighting and every officer of any significance. Why has Petersburg remained relatively understudied? The obvious answer, and almost certainly the correct one, is that scholars have been intimidated by the daunting prospect of doing justice to an event that extended across nearly 300 days, involved four armies, and included ancillary cavalry operations that ranged far from the besieged city. Various historians have examined parts of the overall story, but none has undertaken a full operational treatment. The existing titles, which include a number of very fine ones, thus help readers understand pieces of the campaign, but collectively do not convey a clear picture of the whole. Many general histories of the Civil War avoid any serious discussion of Petersburg altogether, leaving readers with a nebulous sense of military stasis between the forces of Ulysses S. Grant and Robert E. Lee, while operations overseen by William Tecumseh Sherman, Philip H. Sheridan, and other Union generals played out in Georgia, Tennessee, the Shenandoah Valley, and the Carolinas between July 1864 and March 1865. A. Wilson Greene's impressive analytical narrative, A Campaign of Giants, will fill this glaring gap in the military literature on the Civil War. This volume, the first of three projected in the study, takes readers through the end of July 1864, when the Union failure at the Battle of the Crater foreclosed the possibility of a quick end to the drama at Petersburg. Greene's mastery of the subject is abundantly evident, as is his ability, in the course of describing maneuvering and combat, to analyze commanders, engage long-held interpretive conventions, and bring into the picture experiences of both common soldiers and civilians in Petersburg. Greene's text, based on a thorough canvas of primary sources and an admirable command of secondary works, serves as a model of informed, even-handed analysis of numerous topics that have prompted lively disagreement in the literature. Was Lee fooled by Grant's movement across the James River during the second week of June? Who was responsible for the failed Union assaults against very badly outnumbered Confederates on June 15th? How did Benjamin F. Butler retain command of the Army of the James, despite obvious shortcomings? Did the decision not to use African-American units in the first wave of attackers at the crater make a difference? Greene's arguments may not persuade all readers, but they are so well crafted and based on such immersion in the sources that they demand serious consideration. In addition to the quality of his research and analysis, Greene writes in a fashion acceptable to both scholars and non-specialists. This element of his work fits especially well with the Civil War America series's goal of bringing fine scholarship to the broadest possible audience. Greene joins a distinguished group of historians, among them Harry W. Fonts, Robert K. Crick, Earl J. Hess, and Peter Cousins, who have contributed operational and tactical studies to the series. This volume, and the two that follow, will invite contemplation not only of the soldiers and officers who confronted one another at Petersburg, but also, by extension, of the two societies that sent them into action and dealt with the uncertainty and cost of protracted military conflict. Gary W. Gallagher. Preface. I spent 25 years working and living on Petersburg's battlefields, first with the National Park Service and then as the executive director of Pamplin Historical Park, scene of the campaign's climactic attack. During that quarter century, I learned that even the most dedicated students of the American Civil War had an imperfect understanding of those 292 days during which the war's best-known armies grappled over possession of Virginia's second-largest city. I frequently encouraged my professional colleagues to undertake a comprehensive study of the Petersburg story. They all agreed that such an endeavor was needed, but no one agreed to tackle the job. I watched approvingly as Noah Andre Trudeau, The Last Citadel, and Earl J. Hess, In the Trenches at Petersburg, produced excellent one-volume overviews of the campaign. Professionally executed monographs by Thomas J. Howe, Hess, John Horn, Hampton Newsom, and John J. Fox III joined Richard Summers's magisterial Richmond Redeemed in addressing individual aspects of the campaign. I tried to contribute to that effort with books on the campaign's final week and a study of wartime Petersburg. Yet the field still lacked an operational history of the military events between June 1864 and April 1865 that all but sealed the fate of the Confederacy. This volume, the first of three, is the down payment on filling that void. I'm under no illusion that my work is definitive. Such an undertaking would require many more than three volumes. Four armies fought around Petersburg for more than 9 months. The campaign spanned both sides of the James and Appomattox rivers and included cavalry raids that strayed miles from the cockade city. Conventional wisdom tallies some 70,000 casualties in the battles for Petersburg, not to mention the impact, fatal and otherwise, on the 18,000 residents of the Confederacy's seventh-largest metropolis. Military engineering reached its Civil War zenith around Petersburg, soldiers on both sides endured unprecedented living conditions, and the United States conducted an election campaign that levied an enormous impact on the conduct of military operations. A campaign of giants attempts to strike a balance between providing enough tactical detail to satisfy demanding consumers of military history while never losing sight of the campaign's overall context. The perspective of the common soldier finds voice in these pages, even as I address and analyze command decisions at the Army's highest echelons. The first 6 weeks of the Petersburg campaign feature a number of controversies that have intrigued scholars and readers for generations. Issues such as Robert E. Lee's measured response to the Union Army's crossing of the James River, the failure of the Federals to exploit their success on June 15, 1864, the futility of Grant's first offensive despite the Federals' overwhelming numerical superiority, and the preparation for and conduct of the Battle of the Crater receive my attention. I've tried to present the evidence surrounding these episodes and others, and render conclusions based on my reading of the sources. I hope and expect that those conclusions will generate further discussion. Because the Union armies maintained the operational initiative around Petersburg in June and July, I spend considerable time dissecting their inner workings. I have attempted to unravel the relationships among the ranking Federal commanders, Grant, George Meade, and Benjamin Butler. Grant held the most important position in this saga, but his performance in many respects proved disappointing. Readers may be as surprised as I was to discover the many shortcomings in Grant's leadership once his troops crossed the James. The Federals undertook three distinct offensives between June 15th and July 30th. The first, June 15th through 18th, resulted in the capture of a large portion of the original Confederate defense line, but failed to conquer the city. The second offensive, June 22nd through 24th, proved to be a tactical disaster for the Bluecoats, whose effort to cut the railroads leading into Petersburg from the south and the west fell short. It also included a massive cavalry raid that, despite damaging much of the Confederate transportation network leading into Petersburg, ended in defeat. The third offensive, July 26th through 30th, saw a major initiative north of the James River come to naught and featured the campaign's most spectacular combat, the infamous Battle of the Crater. In addition to these significant military initiatives, the cavalry engaged in a number of minor actions, particularly east of Richmond, while the armies around Petersburg sparred in lesser-known actions. African-American troops engaged in significant combat for the first time in the Eastern Theater during the first 6 weeks of the Petersburg Campaign. I have focused considerable attention on their performance and the attitudes toward black troops among Confederates, white Federals, and civilians. The experience of Petersburg's residents during the summer of 1864 warrants its own chapter. 1. War at our own doors. Teenaged Anne Bannister watched in dread as a wagon carrying the lifeless body of her father approached her Petersburg, Virginia home. My precious mother stood like one dazed, but in a few seconds she was kneeling by my father in such grief as I had never seen before, she remembered. Throughout the city, similar vehicles brought dead or mangled men to their distraught families and friends. Night closed in, and we sat down face to face with our woe, wrote one Petersburg resident, some to watch the dying, others to keep vigil beside the dead, while numberless hearts agonized in prayer for loved ones torn from home, and now on their way to pine, and perhaps die, in some northern prison. Bessie Meade Callender, the wife of a local cotton mill manager and part-time militiaman, remembered Friday, June 10, 1864, as the saddest day that ever dawned on Petersburg. 78 citizens, most of them outside the military age limits, had been killed, wounded, or captured the previous day, including 59-year-old William Bannister, one of 15 Petersburg residents who died. The funerals began that morning in most of the city's churches and some private homes, and continued into the next day. "It was a day of mourning for all," recalled Mrs. Callender. The latest in a series of offensives orchestrated by Major General Benjamin F. Butler provided the source of Petersburg's salvation and sadness on June 9th. Nurtured by ambition and operational success in seemingly equal proportion, Butler, the commander of the Union's Army of the James, targeted Petersburg's military resources. He particularly eyed the railroad bridge that spanned the Appomattox River and provided the final link connecting the Confederate capital at Richmond with Virginia's second city, 23 miles to the south. Butler assembled a force of infantry and cavalry numbering roughly 4,600 men, calculating that the advantage of a destructive raid on Petersburg would be cheaply purchased at 500, and not too dearly with the sacrifice of 1,000 men in killed and wounded. Major General Quincy A. Gilmore would lead two columns of infantry on parallel paths against Petersburg's eastern defenses, while Brigadier General August V. Coutts directed 1,300 cavalry around to the city's southeastern portal along Jerusalem Plank Road. Butler understood that the Petersburg fortifications were weak and only thinly defended. One of the few first-class Confederate soldiers stationed in Petersburg confirmed that the trenches were so low that a man would have to get down on his knees in them to cover his head. 1,000 men could have eaten us up almost. Gilmore's march started slowly on the morning of June 9th, affording Petersburg's uniformed defenders sufficient warning to summon the militia. The city's fire bells broke out into chorus with so vigorous a peal and a clangor so resonant as to suggest to the uninitiated a general conflagration, wrote attorney and state legislator Anthony Kiley, who well understood the import of the metallic cacophony. The reserve units, buttressed by 500 soldiers of the 46th Virginia, manned the eastern perimeter, so Kiley and about 125 others of the non-conscribable population headed for the Timothy Reeves farm south of town. Here the eroded fortifications, penetrated by Jerusalem Plank Road, offered scant protection to the ersatz warriors. Brigadier General Raleigh Colston, a veteran of the Army of Northern Virginia without current portfolio, assumed local command, while Brigadier General Henry A. Wise, Petersburg's official commanding officer, rushed northward to seek reinforcements. Gilmore's twin columns encountered rifle and cannon fire from the determined, if grossly outnumbered, defenders that halted the tentative federal advance. The Confederate fortifications formed a projection, or salient, that divided one of Gilmore's columns from contact and cooperation with the other. Reports filtered back to Gilmore's rear echelon headquarters that the position and strength of the enemy would be difficult to conquer, and the Union commander suspended his attack. "As soon as the nature of the works in our front was ascertained," he explained, "I was convinced that an assault upon them would in all probability fail, and I ordered the two positions to be maintained, expecting every moment to hear of General Coutts." His men had suffered 15 casualties out of some 3,300 he brought to the field, a tiny fraction of the human value Butler had placed on destruction of the railroad bridge. A few days later, in noting that Confederate press accounts failed to mention the presence of the federal infantry, Butler wrote one of Gilmore's subordinates that, "I hope the next town we attack we shall get near enough for the enemy to know we are there." The focus then shifted to the Union cavalry south of the city. Coutts commanded the cavalry division in Butler's army, but on June 9th his two brigades of two regiments each were badly under strength. Two guns of the 8th New York Independent Light Artillery and a handful of mountain howitzers constituted all of Coutts's ordnance. Butler assumed that Coutts would face only token resistance, and that his breakthrough would be the signal for Gilmore to rush the eastern fortifications. The ride around to the southern outskirts of Petersburg consumed most of the morning, longer than the Union High Command anticipated. By 11:30 a.m., the vanguard of Coutts's force arrived opposite the works, now manned by about 160 citizen militia under Major Fletcher Archer, a Petersburg lawyer who commanded the 3rd Battalion Virginia Reserves. "What a line it was," recalled Archer. "In number, scarcely more than sufficient to constitute a single company. In dress, nothing to distinguish them in appearance from citizens pursuing the ordinary avocations of life. In age, many of them with heads silvered o'er with the frosts of advancing years, while others could barely boast of the down upon the cheek. In arms and accoutrements such as an impoverished government could afford them." Archer's militia occupied both sides of Jerusalem Plank Road, stretching more than a third of a mile and facing south. The bulk of the men huddled just west of the highway, which had been blocked by an overturned wagon and crude fence rail barriers. Despite the relative weakness of Coutts's nominal division, it still outnumbered its opponents more than 8-1. Armed primarily with smoothbore muskets, the militia was, in the words of Anthony Kiley, "compelled to watch the preparations for our capture or slaughter, much after the fashion that a rational turtle may be presumed to contemplate the preliminaries of a civic dinner in London." Union Brigade Commander Colonel Samuel Speer impetuously called for a squadron of the 11th Pennsylvania Cavalry to charge the Confederate works. "Everyone saw that this was a party we could easily manage," reported Kiley, "and we possessed, therefore, our souls in great patience, till we could see the chevrons on the arm of the non-commissioned officer who led them." A ragged volley erupted from the rebel line, dropping a handful of bluecoats and sending the rest streaming back to the cover of woods. Coutts soon arrived on the scene, condemning the results of Spear's charge as the fate of his stupidity. He then proceeded to err in the opposite extreme. Couts and Spear reconnoitered, dismounted most of their force, and carefully aligned the troopers so that they overlapped both flanks of Archer's little band. By then a single cannon had arrived to bolster the Confederate defenses, causing Couts to unlimber his own guns and engage in an artillery exchange, further delaying the inevitable. The Federals enjoyed a clear advantage in firepower, but Couts used this interlude to work his troopers gradually around the eastern flank of Archer's line. The time expended, however, had allowed word to reach the Confederate Department Commander, General P.G.T. Beauregard, of the developing crisis in Petersburg. By mid-morning, on Beauregard's authority, the 4th North Carolina Cavalry and Captain Edward Graham's Petersburg Battery, under the overall command of Brigadier General James Deering, began a frantic ride from their camps 7 miles north of the city. Crossing the Appomattox River and careening through the streets of town, Graham shouting, "Damn the women! Run them over if they don't get out of the way!" These welcome reinforcements headed for the heights at the south end of the city. By this time, Couts's overcautious tactics had succeeded in gaining the flank and rear of Archer's weary volunteers. "We fought them, till we were so surrounded that the two nearest men to me were shot in the back while facing the line of original approach," Kiley lamented. "One by one, my comrades fell around me," he observed, before joining a number of other militia as captives. "The enemy trooped over the earthwork behind me, and the foremost, presenting his loaded carbine, demanded my surrender with an unrepeatable violence of language that suggested bloodshed. All avenue of escape being cut off, I yielded with what grace I could to my fate, captive to the bow and spear of a hatchet-faced member of the 1st District Cavalry, greatly enamored of this honorable opportunity of going to the rear." Archer's losses exceeded 50%, but the 2 hours he stymied the Union cavalry bought Deering and Graham time to deploy behind the city reservoir, on high ground overlooking the Union route of approach. The Yankees dawdled even longer, interrogating prisoners, looting the Confederate camps, and burning the Reeves house. But eventually Couts sent his men northward on Jerusalem Plank Road. When they reached the intersection with New Road, most of the troopers turned northwest toward the reservoir, while others continued due north, aiming for the heights called Wells Hill, on which stood the ruins of Blandford Church. Both columns faced Confederate fire, and Spear mistook the walls of the reservoir for a strong stockade. Presented with additional resistance and hearing nothing from the Union infantry, in fact, Gilmore had ordered a retreat by then, Couts considered discretion the better part of valor, and directed his troopers to fall back and return to their camps. Petersburg had been spared. The drama of June 9th merely marked the most recent in a stream of threats that had imperiled Petersburg for 5 weeks. The chief architect of that menace, Benjamin Butler, left a distinct impression on everyone who encountered him. A Massachusetts Democrat of enormous influence, Butler's staunch support of the Union war effort earned him early military prominence. His timely arrival in Annapolis, Maryland during the war's opening days, his subsequent declaration at Virginia's Fort Monroe that runaway slaves should be considered contraband of war, and his role in 1862 as conqueror of New Orleans, the Confederacy's largest metropolis, kept him in the headlines, a place Butler coveted. Controversy about the ethics of his administration of occupied New Orleans sidelined his military career for nearly a year. But in November 1863, Butler assumed command of the Department of Virginia and North Carolina, something of a backwater assignment with responsibility for the Union-controlled coastal regions of those two states. Butler's appearance, as much as his accomplishments, arrested people's attention. Short, fat, shapeless, no neck, squinting, and very bald-headed, was how one Union officer sized him up. Another pronounced the general a queer-looking man, admitting, "His beauty won't kill him." No one painted a more vivid picture than prisoner of war Anthony Kiley, who was brought to Butler for questioning following the fighting on June 9th. Upon his first glimpse of the Union commander, Kiley felt, profound gratitude to God, who creates no mortal enemy to man without clothing it with features that excite the instant and instinctive aversion of the entire human race. To Benjamin F. Butler's face, scarce an element is wanting of absolute repulsiveness. Rapacity finds appropriate expression in his vulture nose, sensuality in his heavy pendant jaws, despotism in his lowering eyebrow. And to these facial charms is added an optical derangement which permits him to scrutinize you with his left eye, the one he seems to place the most dependence on, while the right, revolving in a different plane, wanders away in another field of vision. Add to this a cool complacency of speech and gesture, which assures you he is on best of terms with his portly self, and I fancy you will have a description which will convince you that nature has hung out the sign of villain in every lineament of the brute's physiognomy. By the spring of 1864, Butler controlled a field army nearly 40,000 strong, including infantry corps under Major Generals William F. Baldy Smith and Gilmore, along with Coutts's cavalry. He met with the new Union General-in-Chief, Lieutenant General Ulysses S. Grant, in early April, and received orders to participate in a three-pronged offensive in Virginia. Butler's job would be to steam up the James River from his base at Fort Monroe, land at City Point, the confluence of the Appomattox and James Rivers, 8 miles northeast of Petersburg, and on the Bermuda Hundred Peninsula between those two tidal waterways, and cooperate with Grant in operations against the Confederate capital. "Richmond is to be your objective point," Grant explained. "This indicates the necessity of your holding close to the south bank of the James River as you advance." Nowhere in these instructions did Grant mention Petersburg. Butler's fleet left Hampton Roads at the mouth of the James on May 5th, and by late afternoon began disgorging thousands of soldiers less than a day's march from Petersburg. The local Confederate commander, Major General George E. Pickett, had been warning the War Department in Richmond of the potential threat posed by Butler's massive army, but Pickett's penchant for crying wolf had undermined his credibility. Fortunately, his immediate superior, General Beauregard, gave Pickett's pleas some credence. Beauregard promptly began forwarding reinforcements from North Carolina, where he maintained the headquarters of his Department of North Carolina and Southern Virginia, which included a district composed of Petersburg and the land north to the James River. Until these troops arrived, Pickett would have only 500 veterans and a few local militiamen to defend both Petersburg and the Richmond and Petersburg Railroad that connected the two cities. Butler's forces began disembarking at 4 p.m. without opposition, but on the advice of his corps commanders, Butler failed to move toward the railroad only several miles to the west. The next afternoon, Butler cautiously advanced westward with a single brigade under Brigadier General Charles Heckman. Heckman encountered newly arrived Confederates near a small rail intersection called Port Walthall Junction, and despite enjoying numerical superiority of more than 4-1, he sustained 68 casualties and called it a day. Butler fumed, blaming General Gilmore for timidity and disobedience of orders, and immediately employed his political connections to thwart Senate confirmation of Gilmore's major generalcy. While the Federal infantry dithered at Bermuda Hundred, General Coutts targeted the Petersburg Railroad, the line that connected Petersburg with Weldon, North Carolina, and ultimately with the critical Confederate port at Wilmington, North Carolina. The Union raiders destroyed two important bridges along that line on May 7th and 8th, and then headed for City Point, having successfully compromised Petersburg's southern line of supply and reinforcement. Pickett, his force growing from almost hourly accretions, then sacrificed his northern communications when, on the night of May 7th, despite having turned back another federal probe near Port Walthall Junction, he withdrew south across Swift Creek, a major tributary of the Appomattox River. The Federals had snipped the telegraph line between Richmond and Petersburg and damaged a small section of the railroad during their May 7th offensive. The overstressed Confederate commander, on the brink of an emotional breakdown, felt that Petersburg now faced peril from the north, south, and east, and sought to consolidate his strength closer to the city. Thanks to the speed with which Beauregard had dispatched his brigades from the Carolinas, and despite Coutts's depredations, Pickett had assembled about 5,000 infantry and 18 cannon on the south bank of Swift Creek by the morning of May 8th. Butler still enjoyed a huge numerical advantage, but opted to spend the day improving his fortified camp on Bermuda 100 while allowing Grant more time to fight his way toward Richmond. That evening, Butler gave orders to renew offensive operations. "The enemy are in our front with cavalry, 5,000 men, and it is a disgrace that we are cooped up here," Butler admonished General Gilmore, his favorite whipping boy. The Union commander would commit all but three of his brigades in an attempt to destroy the Richmond and Petersburg Railroad, while a portion of his force demonstrated against Pickett's defenses along Swift Creek to prevent the Confederates from interfering. The May 9th operations against the railroad succeeded splendidly. The Yankees lifted significant sections of rails, particularly near Chester Station, midway between Richmond and Petersburg, and placed them in piles over the ties before setting them ablaze, warping the iron beyond repair. As the rest of Butler's men approached the Swift Creek line, elements of Brigadier General Johnson Haygood's South Carolina Brigade imprudently crossed the creek and attacked the Union vanguard at a cost of nearly 140 casualties. Confederates on the south bank repulsed the half-hearted Union pursuit of Haygood's routed regiments. That evening, Butler boasted of his achievements during the first 4 days of his campaign to Secretary of War Edwin M. Stanton. "We've landed here, entrenched ourselves, destroyed many miles of railroad, and got a position which, with proper supplies, we can hold out against the whole of Lee's army," Butler explained. Beauregard, with a large portion of his command, was left south by the cutting of the railroads by Coutts. "That portion which reached Petersburg I have whipped today, killing and wounding many and taking many prisoners, after a severe and well-contested fight. General Grant will not be troubled with any further reinforcements to Lee from Beauregard's force." Late that afternoon, Butler met with Smith and Gilmore to discuss options for the next day. Because they had no information suggesting that a rendezvous with Grant along the James was imminent, the trio agreed to move against Petersburg. The railroad bridges over Swift Creek and the Appomattox River attracted their special attention. U.S. colored troops under Brigadier General Edward Hinks, the force that had occupied City Point since May 5th, would cooperate by moving southwest toward Petersburg's eastern defenses. That evening, Gilmore and Smith undermined their already shaky relationship with Butler by suggesting an entirely different plan for attacking Petersburg. But in the end, the Army of the James would abandon any notion of menacing the city. A series of messages from Stanton advised Butler that Grant had gained a substantial victory and was en route to the planned convergence along the James. "General Grant is on the march, with his whole army to form a junction with you," reported the jubilant Secretary of War. Stanton's information would prove grossly inaccurate as Grant, traveling with Major General George G. Meade's Army of the Potomac, was at that moment stalled in front of Spotsylvania Courthouse, some 50 miles northwest of Richmond. Butler knew nothing of that, of course, and immediately canceled his plans to attack Pickett, again withdrawing into Bermuda 100. There, he planned to return to the original strategy that called for him to approach Richmond from the south. The next morning, May 10th, General Beauregard finally arrived in Petersburg from Weldon and relieved the enervated Pickett, who retired to the care of his teenaged wife. "We are still in the midst of the hurly-burly produced by the descent of the Yankees upon City Point and Bermuda 100," reported the Petersburg Daily Express. "For the last 6 days we have had the war at our own doors, and our people know what it is to be troubled by the proximity of a Vandal enemy." Little did they realize how close they had come to disaster. It is highly doubtful that the outnumbered Confederates could have successfully resisted a concerted attempt by Butler to take their city on May 10th. Grant's immediate threat to Richmond was illusory, but Federal cavalry under Major General Philip H. Sheridan posed a more tangible danger to the Confederate capital. Leaving the Spotsylvania area on May 9th, Sheridan led some 10,000 troopers south, spreading panic in under-defended Richmond. "This city is in hot danger," reported Confederate Secretary of War James Seddon. "It should be defended with all our resources to the sacrifice of minor considerations," which included, apparently, the defense of Petersburg. Seddon ordered Beauregard to move his troops north to unite with the small Richmond garrison, in position to either repulse the Union raiders or block a northward thrust by Butler. Beauregard shifted most of two makeshift divisions north, right past Butler, who remained inactive within Bermuda Hundred, to the Confederate strongpoint at Drury's Bluff, a mere 8 road miles below Richmond, while additional troops arrived in Petersburg from North Carolina. Butler moved in Beauregard's wake, marching north toward the Confederate defenders. The gray-clad commander, always a visionary in matters of military strategy, wanted to combine with General Robert E. Lee's Army of Northern Virginia, which was still locked in combat with the Army of the Potomac at Spotsylvania, to defeat Butler and Grant seriatim. Confederate President Jefferson Davis, who conferred with Beauregard at Drury's Bluff, vetoed this patently impractical plan. The Creole general did not completely abandon his offensive instincts, however. He choreographed a twin assault for May 16th. While his troops struck the Yankees in front, a force from Petersburg under Major General William H.C. Whiting would assault the Federals in their rear. Together, Beauregard and Whiting would destroy the Army of the James. In the event, Whiting lost his nerve and halted well short of the Federals, while Beauregard's determined, if uncoordinated, assaults succeeded in driving Butler away from Drury's Bluff, but into safety at his fortified camp on Bermuda Hundred. Beauregard followed, and on May 20th, near Ware Bottom Church, succeeded in establishing a compact defensive line east of the turnpike and railroad connecting Richmond and Petersburg, blocking Butler from moving west. Although the Federals still enjoyed free access to their naval transportation along the James, and could cross the Appomattox River at will on pontoon bridges eventually built at Point of Rocks and Broadway Landing downstream from Petersburg, the threats he had posed to Richmond and Petersburg since May 5th had been temporarily neutralized. Though repulsed, Butler had not abandoned offensive inclinations. On May 27th, he developed plans to send Smith with 11,000 men across the Appomattox, link with Hinks's African-American forces, and dash into Petersburg's eastern precincts. Beauregard's army had been depleted by detachments summoned by Lee to replace losses sustained in the bloody combat north of Richmond, lending promise to the Federals' initiative. Butler set May 29th as the day for his assault. Grant, however, also needed fresh levies to make good his battle casualties, and on May 28th transports arrived to ferry Smith's corps to the Army of the Potomac, northeast of Richmond. "I grieve much that this weakness of the Army of the Potomac has called the troops away," groused Butler, "just as we were taking the offensive, and that the attack on Petersburg must be abandoned." Butler plotted against Petersburg yet again a few days later, this time intending to employ Coutts and Hinks to raid the city, burning the bridges and destroying public buildings. Beauregard postponed those plans by launching an energetic reconnaissance against Butler's defenses at Bermuda Hundred on June 2nd, distracting the Federal commander until June 9th, when Butler did conduct the raid he intended to make a week earlier. The shameful lack of initiative by Gilmore, and Coutts's lethargic offensive south of town against Petersburg's old men and young boys, brought an end to Butler's independent campaigning south of the James. George Meade, Ulysses S. Grant, and the Army of the Potomac now entered the picture. George Gordon Meade had commanded the primary Union Army in the Eastern Theater since late June 1863. Within days of his promotion, Meade turned back Lee's raid into Pennsylvania at Gettysburg. But in the eyes of his political enemies, much of the press, and President Abraham Lincoln, his dilatory pursuit allowed Lee to escape to Virginia without further damage. For the remainder of the year, Meade conducted a relatively bloodless dance with Lee in Virginia's northern Piedmont, including an aborted offensive in late November along a tributary of the Rapidan River called Mine Run. Widespread opprobrium for not striking the Confederates a fatal blow marked only one of the handicaps with which Meade would enter the spring campaign. The general possessed a personality that seemed to alienate everyone, including those subordinates most critical to his army's success. "I have long known Meade to be a man of the worst possible temper, especially toward his subordinates," wrote a civilian official with the War Department. "I do not think he has a friend in the army." A staff officer declared Meade to be a very mean man, and one of his aides considered him severe but manly, while admitting, "It is praise not to be pitched into by the great Peppery." When Congress resurrected the rank of lieutenant general and bestowed it on Grant in March 1864, Meade's status at the head of the nation's most important army seemed in doubt. The Pennsylvanian offered to step aside, but Grant retained him, impressed by his willingness to give way to someone of Grant's own choosing and by his successful track record at various levels of command. General Meade was an officer of great merit, with drawbacks to his usefulness that were beyond his control, remembered Grant. "He was brave and conscientious, and commanded the respect of all who knew him. He was unfortunately of a temper that would get beyond his control at times, and make him speak to officers of high rank in the most offensive manner." Meade fully appreciated Grant's confidence, but privately expressed disappointment that future triumphs would now be credited to another man. How well these two leaders would cooperate in such close proximity remained a major question on the eve of the spring campaign. Grant's decision to make his headquarters in the field with the Army of the Potomac would assuage the president's concerns about Meade's lack of aggressiveness, and at the same time remove the new general-in-chief from the distraction of Washington politics. Grant and Lincoln had established almost instant rapport and a mutual trust that would prove essential in the coming months. The new general-in-chief would direct the primary May initiative by the Army of the Potomac, Butler's offensive up the James, and a third thrust through the Shenandoah Valley aimed at the Virginia Central Railroad and that bucolic region's agricultural fecundity. Grant came to Virginia as the most celebrated soldier in the land. His victories at Vicksburg and Chattanooga the previous year had eliminated one Confederate army and scattered another. Earlier in the war, he had earned the nom de guerre, Unconditional Surrender Grant, in winning the first important Union victory at Fort Donelson, Tennessee. His tenacity and unflappable demeanor in battle had shown in April 1862. When he endured a pounding during the first day's engagement at the Battle of Shiloh, only to calmly regain all the lost ground the next day in a series of determined counterattacks. But the Army of the Potomac presented a new challenge. It harbored intense affection for its former commander, Major General George B. McClellan, and had learned to be skeptical of heroes from the West, such as Major General John Pope, who led portions of the army to defeat in August 1862 at the Second Battle of Manassas. Artillery Colonel Charles S. Wainwright found Grant to be stumpy, unmilitary, slouchy, and Western-looking, very ordinary, in fact. Although Grant possessed none of what is often called in the army fuss and feathers, the opinionated Lieutenant Colonel Theodore Lyman of Meade's staff thought him to be the concentration of all that is American. Lieutenant Colonel Charles Cummings of the 17th Vermont told his wife that Grant is a sandy-complexioned, hard, wiry-looking man with a short, stiff beard, and if physiognomy is good for anything, is as obstinate as he is represented. Grant arrived at Meade's headquarters near Brandy Station, along the Orange and Alexandria Railroad on March 10th. He soon established his own command post in nearby Culpeper, hard by the sprawling camps of Meade's army north of the Rapidan River, and gradually developed his operational plan for the spring campaign. In addition to the tripartite offensive in Virginia, Grant directed his successor in the Western Theater, Major General William T. Sherman, to operate against the Confederate Army under General Joseph E. Johnston in northwest Georgia. Meade would receive similar orders to target Robert E. Lee and the Army of Northern Virginia. "Lee's army will be your objective point," Grant wrote on April 9th. "Wherever Lee goes, there you will go also." For 3 years, Union commanders in Virginia had focused on the capture of the Confederate capital, as if the conquest of Richmond equaled ultimate victory. Grant changed that strategic calculus. He hoped to catch Lee in the open, well north of the Virginia metropolis, and win the decisive victory that the northern public craved. However, Grant pragmatically thought it more likely that the armies would eventually confront one another around Richmond. "I shall aim to fight Lee between here and Richmond if he will stand," Grant told Butler. "But should Lee fall back into Richmond, I will follow up and make a junction with your army on the James River." Grant understood that the campaign might degenerate into a stalemate and corresponded with Meade in mid-April about that eventuality. One historian described Grant's impending operation as an essay in improvisation, but nothing in Grant's orders reflected a desire to engage in a war of attrition, as that grim game of arithmetic would not necessarily redound in the Union's favor. Although the Army of the Potomac counted 76,629 infantry, 12,864 cavalry, and 7,780 artillery present for duty equipped at the end of April, many of those men anticipated the expiration of their enlistment terms during the campaign season. Counting the independent Ninth Corps, which would travel with Meade's army, but report to Grant as a separate force, the Federals could boast nearly 117,000 combatants. Of that number, however, barely half were veterans, and many of the rest new conscripts or bounty men whose motivations for serving and lack of field experience gave their officers pause. Grant's Goliath did not match the common perception of overwhelming strength, and certainly did not suggest that trading two lives for one would win the war. On paper, to be sure, the Union forces in Virginia vastly outnumbered their opponents. The Army of Northern Virginia had wintered south of the Rapidan River in Orange County, and by April had welcomed the return of Lieutenant General James Longstreet's First Corps from its fall foray into Tennessee. Lee could count on, perhaps, 64,000 men. His infantry was divided into three corps under Longstreet and Lieutenant Generals Richard S. Ewell and Ambrose Powell Hill. Major General James Ewell Brown Stewart led Lee's cavalry, and the artillery could put 213 guns into battery, one-third fewer than the Federals. Although Stewart retained Lee's confidence, all of Lee's infantry chieftains inspired doubt. Ewell, in charge of the Second Corps, and Hill at the head of the Third Corps, had both disappointed Lee since their elevation the previous summer. Longstreet had failed miserably in independent command after being banished from the Army of Tennessee by the irascible General Braxton Bragg, and had shown evidence of petulance at Gettysburg. While Grant counted on men of dubious quality to swell his ranks, the South had all but exhausted its available manpower by the spring of 1864. Lee worried not about the expiration of enlistments, as a recent law ensured that Confederate soldiers would serve for the duration of the war, but he could expect few replacements for battle casualties or the attrition of disease. Beauregard's scattered army guarded his southern flank from the James River to Cape Fear. A force of roughly 6,600 men under Major General John C. Breckinridge occupied the upper Shenandoah Valley, and about 7,100 artillerists and second-tier reserves and militia constituted Richmond's immediate garrison. Disparity of numbers represented only one of Lee's handicaps on the eve of the campaign. A crippling scarcity of supplies from man and beast tempered Lee's natural instinct to assume the offensive. The Confederate commander had been forced to scatter his horses to pastures far removed from the army's encampments in order to find them adequate sustenance. More worrisome still, as the winter gave way to spring, provisions for Lee's troops continued to shrink. Lee had informed the Secretary of War in January that short rations are having a bad effect upon the men, both morally and physically. The men cannot continue healthy and vigorous if confined to this spare diet for any length of time. Nearly 3 months later, the situation had not materially improved. "I cannot see how we can operate with our present supplies," Lee warned Jefferson Davis on April 12th. Privations led to a steady stream of desertions throughout the winter, causing Lee to prophesy that, "Unless there is a change, I fear the army cannot be kept effective, and probably cannot be kept together." Despite the impediments of slim numbers and inadequate supplies, morale in the Army of Northern Virginia remained surprisingly high during the spring of 1864. The persona of the army commander accounted for the lion's share of that optimism. "General Robert E. Lee is regarded by his army as nearest approaching the character of the great and good Washington than any man living," testified Georgia Brigadier Clement A. Evans. "He is the only man living in whom they would unreservedly trust all power for the preservation of their independence." Moreover, the Southern press echoed the feeling shared within the ranks that Grant would be no match for the indomitable Marse Robert. "The Yankees call him Unconditional Surrender Grant," admitted one confident Confederate. "Our men already have given him a name. Up the Spout Grant." The soldiers showed Lee their unmistakable devotion when the army commander attended an April review of Longstreet's corps. "You never saw such cheering in your life," marveled one rebel. The troops pressed around Lee, seeking to touch his horse, or better yet, brush the general's leg in passing. "A wave of sentiment seemed to sweep over the field," remembered an artillery officer. "All felt the bond which held them together. There was no speaking, but the effect was as of a military sacrament." One Confederate stated the matter with perfect clarity. "Every man in that army believed that Robert E. Lee was the greatest man alive." Longstreet's return to Lee's army ended Confederate flirtations with complicated strategies targeting Kentucky or Middle Tennessee with some combination of Johnston's Army of Tennessee, Longstreet's detached corps, and the Army of Northern Virginia. The question now revolved around where Lee would make his stand against an anticipated Union offensive across the Rapidan, since supply problems eliminated any hope for an early Southern offensive in the Old Dominion. "We have got to whip them. We must whip them," Lee advised his aide, Lieutenant Colonel Walter H. Taylor, a month before Grant moved south. Lee enjoyed at least two defensive options that would exploit river barriers passable only at fords or bridges. The North Anna River flowed across Grant's probable line of march toward Richmond, midway between the Confederate capital and Fredericksburg. The south bank of that stream dominated the ground, and there Lee could protect a compact supply line, while Grant's communications would extend nearly 75 miles from northern Virginia. The proximity to Richmond would also allow better coordination between Beauregard's forces and Lee's. Lee rejected a movement south, however, preferring to defend the Rapidan, which had been the de facto border between the armies since early December. The Confederates had erected fortifications south of the river, and remaining there would permit Lee room to maneuver, and potentially shorten the distance required to carry the war across the Potomac once again, or at least into northern Virginia. He could always retreat to the North Anna if circumstances so required. Just as at Fredericksburg the previous winter, when the Rappahannock River divided blue from gray, Lee dispersed his forces along more than 20 miles of riverfront. Ewell and Hill remained vigilant opposite the fords where Union pickets lounged on the Rapidan's north shore, while Stuart's cavalry patrolled flanks upstream and down from the infantry. Longstreet's corps remained in reserve near Gordonsville, in a position to react to a federal threat to the Shenandoah Valley, Richmond, or the Rapidan frontier. Lee assembled a unique conclave of his corps and division commanders on May 2nd atop Clark's Mountain, a rounded outlier of the Blue Ridge that afforded a panoramic view of the surrounding countryside. The officers scanned the federal camps and clearly discerned evidence of an impending move. The question remained, as it had the previous year, where would the Federals attempt a crossing? After due consideration, Lee predicted that the enemy would move toward the Confederate right, utilizing Germanna and Ely's fords downstream from the southern camps. He could not be absolutely certain of Grant's intentions, but he ordered Ewell and Hill to prepare to march east at the first evidence of Grant's anticipated line of march. Lee judged correctly. Once Grant had developed his concept of simultaneous advances in Georgia, the Shenandoah Valley, up the James River, and against Lee, he still wondered where to initiate Meade's portion of the work. Attempting a crossing into the teeth of Lee's river defenses made no sense, so the choice was reduced to which flank, upstream or down, the Federals would attempt to turn. Although a movement to the federal right upstream on the Rapidan promised ready mobility through a more open and cultivated country, the matter of supply dictated the other option. As Meade's chief of staff, Major General Andrew A. Humphreys, explained later, "In moving by our left flank, we should abandon our line of supply by the Alexandria Railroad, and at once open short routes of communication from our protected flank, the left, to navigable waters connected with Washington and other depots of supply. No protecting force would be necessary to cover these short land routes." Humphreys drafted the orders for the advance, and Grant designated midnight of May 3rd to 4th as the beginning of the offensive. As the Blue Legions began their march for the Rapidan crossings, Grant knew full well that he would be subjecting Meade's army to a grueling experience. The campaign now begun was destined to result in heavier losses to both armies in a given time than any previously suffered, thought Grant. The Union General-in-Chief understood that winning the war necessitated destroying Lee's army, and Sherman doing the same to Johnston's in Georgia, and such annihilation would require hard fighting over a sustained period. He also realized that the reduction of Richmond would likely be the result, not the cause, of defeating Lee's army. Lee would be obliged to defend that logistical, industrial, and political hub, just as Johnston would be compelled to protect Atlanta. "To get possession of Lee's army was the first great object," wrote Grant. "With the capture of his army, Richmond would necessarily follow." Federal cavalry encountered only token resistance from mounted vedettes at the designated fords, and by mid-morning May 4th, swarms of Union soldiers streamed into Orange County and the forbidding terrain known locally as the Wilderness. This region of second and third growth scrub forest had been mined for iron for a century and a half, and soil that yielded ore offered limited productivity to farmers. Consequently, few roads penetrated the wilderness, which hosted only scattered clearings, cultivated primarily by hardscrabble residents. Humphreys's plan called for a quick dash through this inhospitable terrain, where Grant's preponderance of artillery and infantry would matter less than on more open ground. But Meade worried about the security of his huge wagon train, on which the army depended until a new waterborne base of supply could be established. Thus, the army's pace conformed to the slow crawl of hundreds of vehicles. By day's end on May 4th, most of the Union army had bivouacked in the heart of the wilderness, stopping hours before sunset to allow the wagons to catch up. Meade compounded this error by reducing the cavalry reconnaissance from 3 divisions to 1, while the remaining horsemen guarded the supplies from phantom rebel raiders. The Army of the Potomac was thus rendered partially blind, and, to make matters worse, the commander of the reconnoitering division, Brigadier General James Harrison Wilson, had only administrative experience with the mounted arm, and had never commanded troops in combat. Lee's eyes, on the other hand, were wide open. Information from watchful pickets, Observations from Clark's Mountain, and garrulous Union deserters all confirmed that the Federal Army was on the move toward Germanna and Ely's Fords. Lee ordered Ewell to march east along the Orange Turnpike to intercept the Yankees, while Hill proceeded on the parallel Orange Plank Road a few miles to the south. Lee hedged his bet by detaching one of Ewell's brigades and an entire division of Hill's corps to keep an eye on the upper Rapidan, just in case Grant and Meade had some sort of double envelopment up their sleeves. Longstreet began the approach of his two available First Corps divisions on a third road, even farther south, hoping to slice in below the Union Army and pin the invaders in the wilderness. It would take Longstreet an extra day to cover the ground from his distant starting point near Gordonsville, so Lee admonished Ewell and Hill to avoid initiating a general engagement until Longstreet arrived. Events soon confounded the intentions of both commanders. The Union V Corps stumbled into Ewell's divisions along the turnpike on the morning of May 5th. Grant, consistent with his philosophy of attacking the Confederates wherever he found them, ordered the 5th Corps commander, Major General Gouverneur K. Warren, to drive through the rebels, signaling the beginning of the Battle of the Wilderness. Fighting raged for 2 days along the parallel Turnpike and Plank Road, with both armies trading attacks and counterattacks that swept across roadside clearings into dense forest. When the sun set on May 6th, some 30,000 soldiers had been shot or captured, including Longstreet, wounded by his own men at the peak of a successful flanking maneuver on May 6th, under circumstances eerily reminiscent of the accident that befell Thomas J. Stonewall Jackson, not 5 miles to the northeast, almost exactly 1 year earlier. Both armies expected the fighting to continue on May 7th. But except for minor skirmishing, Lee and Meade were content to reorganize their shattered brigades, treat their wounded, and bury their dead. Grant, however, dictated the next chapter in the series of battles that would be known as the Overland Campaign. He recognized three options on the morning of May 7th, in addition to the profitless course of remaining static behind his wilderness works. He might retreat, as his predecessors had done after their engagements with Lee on the south side of the Rappahannock-Rapidan frontier, but he gave this choice no consideration. Instead, he pondered forward movements, either east to Fredericksburg or south toward the Crossroads County Seat village of Spotsylvania Courthouse. A movement to Fredericksburg would reestablish his supply line via the Potomac River. Lee no doubt would shift accordingly, placing the Army of Northern Virginia between Grant and Richmond. A swift dash toward Spotsylvania, however, might put the Federals closer to Richmond than Lee, compelling Lee to attack in the open where Grant liked his odds, or fall back closer to the Confederate capital, passively sacrificing miles of Virginia real estate. By 6:30 on the morning of the 7th, Grant had made his decision. He sent orders to Meade to undertake a night march toward Spotsylvania on a series of roads designed to expedite the 10-mile trek. He also directed Major General Ambrose E. Burnside to cooperate with Meade's advance. Burnside commanded the 9th Corps, but because he outranked Meade, the bewhiskered Rhode Islander remained under Grant's immediate control. A clumsy arrangement that would be corrected within a fortnight by incorporating the 9th Corps into the Army of the Potomac, with Burnside's cheerful concurrence. Grant wished to keep the pressure on Lee, partly because that was his operational bias, but also because he had heard of Butler's landing at Bermuda Hundred and wanted to dissuade Lee from detaching troops to confront the Army of the James. Lee's huge losses and the Federals' strong position compelled the Confederates to remain in a reactive posture on May 7th. The Yankees had taken the initiative, and there was little Lee could do about it. He spent part of the day selecting Longstreet's successor, settling on Major General Richard H. Anderson of South Carolina. Anderson had compiled a frankly mediocre record as a division commander, first under Longstreet and most recently in Hill's Third Corps. But his familiarity with the commanders and culture of the First Corps recommended his promotion. Lee simultaneously wrestled with divining Grant's next move. A reconnaissance toward Germanna Ford informed him that the Federals had abandoned their primary connection to the Rapidan, suggesting that a Union retreat was not imminent and that Grant would require a new line of communications. Either Fredericksburg or Spotsylvania would serve that purpose. Some sources assert that Lee predicted with immediate certainty that the Federals would aim for Spotsylvania. Lee did order his artillery commander, Brigadier General William Nelson Pendleton, to supervise the clearing of a road that led from the Army's right flank southward toward Spotsylvania Courthouse. But that proves no particular prescience. Lee simply understood that whether the Federals marched for Fredericksburg or Spotsylvania, he would do well to occupy the hamlet in a position to respond to whichever course the Unionists might follow. He issued orders early that evening for Anderson to shift his corps toward Spotsylvania as soon as darkness could shield his withdrawal. Meade's movement to Spotsylvania began on schedule that night, but narrow roads and stubborn Confederate cavalry reduced Federal progress to a crawl. Anderson enjoyed the best performance of his military career as he directed his two divisions southward with sufficient persistence and speed to beat the Yankees to their destination by mere moments. Vicious fighting ensued as both armies deployed along parallel lines in a semicircle north and west of Spotsylvania Courthouse. The stage was now set for nearly 2 weeks of maneuver and mayhem along the well-settled plateau between the Po and Knee rivers. The Army of the Potomac lost two of its corps commanders on May 9th, one to a fatal wound. That morning, a sharpshooter's bullet cut down Major General John Sedgwick, the beloved leader of the Sixth Corps. Brigadier General Horatio G. Wright, a division commander and brilliant engineer with a limited combat record, replaced Uncle John. In the meantime, Phil Sheridan and the bulk of his cavalry corps trotted out of Spotsylvania County bound for Richmond. Sheridan had come east with Grant that spring, and he enjoyed the complete confidence of the general-in-chief. When the diminutive Irishman clashed insubordinately with crusty George Meade over the proper use of the cavalry, Grant ignored military protocol and sided with Sheridan, and with his protégé's preference to strike out on his own. It was this initiative that had so worried the Richmond authorities for the safety of their capital. Lee's losses at the highest level of command exceeded those of the Federals. In addition to Longstreet's wound, which would require more than 5 months to heal, on the morning of May 8th, A.P. Hill reported himself too ill to continue in the field. Major General Jubal A. Early, a division commander under Ewell, temporarily filled his place. Ewell's own health, psychological as much as physical, deteriorated as the pressure on his corps mounted, particularly on May 12th. That morning, a massive Federal assault on a salient the soldiers called the Mule Shoe resulted in stunning casualties in the Second Corps, including the capture of one of Ewell's divisions almost whole. By the 19th, Ewell appeared unequal to his position, and Lee would diplomatically relieve him in due course, consigning the one-legged Virginian to a less stressful billet. Then Jeb Stuart fell. Sheridan's primary accomplishment during his giant raid toward the Confederate capital was to inflict a mortal wound on Lee's cavalry commander near a roadside inn called Yellow Tavern, a few miles north of Richmond. Stuart died at the Richmond home of his brother-in-law on May 12th. Between May 8th and 21st, Grant would launch attacks against Lee's left and center and attempt to twist around his right, all for naught. The carnage at Spotsylvania proved every bit as horrendous as that in the wilderness. The Federals suffered in excess of 18,000 losses while whittling Lee's army down by about 12,000. In little more than 2 weeks, combat had reduced the armies by nearly 60,000 men. Grant remained undaunted. "I propose to fight it out on this line if it takes all summer," he told Major General Henry W. Halleck, the Army's Washington-based chief of staff. Grant apparently did not anticipate that his campaign against Lee would extend beyond August or September. The outnumbered Army of Northern Virginia had taken maximum advantage of massive field fortifications, built with haste and skill to shield itself from Grant's hammer blows. The Union commander now turned to subterfuge to lure Lee into the open. On the night of May 20th, the Second Corps, under the competent leadership of Major General Winfield S. Hancock, slipped out of the trenches at Spotsylvania heading south. Hancock's 20,000 men would serve as bait, tempting Lee to rush after these isolated Federals and strike them a blow. Doing so would expose the Confederates to attack from Warren's men, perhaps joined by Burnside's and Wright's corps, at last bringing Lee to bay away from the equalizing embankments of dirt and logs that had proven so effective at Spotsylvania. Hancock's brigades played their game flawlessly, taking a strong position near Milford Station on the Richmond, Fredericksburg, and Potomac Railroad, temptingly separated from the rest of the army. But Lee refused to cooperate. He quickly detected Hancock's departure, but rather than chasing after him, Lee made for the North Anna River, about 23 miles south of Spotsylvania. By May 22nd, the Confederates were camped safely on the south bank of the river, confident in the belief that both armies would relish the opportunity to rest and refit. In this, Lee was badly mistaken. Grant and Meade rushed their army south, and on May 23rd crossed the North Anna beyond Lee's left flank, at the same time driving a small Confederate outpost on the north shore across the river in abject defeat. Lee chastised the recently returned A.P. Hill for allowing the Federals to breach the river barrier, and then conducted a council of war to determine the best course of action. The plan that emerged is widely considered one of the most brilliant of the war. That night the Confederates fell back from the river, out of sight of their enemy, except for holding commanding ground overlooking a crossing point called Oxford. Lee anchored both his flanks on watercourses and waited for the Federals to advance. Grant would oblige. Finding the Confederates gone and apparently in retreat on the morning of the 24th, the Federal commander ordered his corps to pursue. The 5th and 6th on his right, already across the river, the 2nd to push across the North Anna on the left, and Burnside's men to span the stream at Oxford in the Union center. Grant had no idea that Lee waited expectantly behind his defenses, the so-called inverted V line, to strike the Federals as they waltzed into his trap. Burnside would be stymied at Oxford, while Hancock would be alone on the eastern side of the field, subject to assault by a combination of Confederate forces utilizing interior lines. If all went according to plan, Lee would strike a crippling blow to a fraction of Meade's army, separated from potential reinforcement by one or two river crossings. "He now had one of those opportunities that occur but rarely in war," commented one of Grant's aides, "but which, in the grasp of a master, make or mar the fortunes of armies, and decide the result of campaigns." The attack never occurred. For a few tantalizing hours, Hancock's reinforced divisions of about 24,000 faced a possible combination of 30,000 Confederates. But the Army of Northern Virginia failed to move. Severe dysentery confined Lee to his headquarters tent, where he repeatedly advised, "We must strike them a blow. We must never let them pass us again. We must strike them a blow." None of Lee's corps commanders, the recently promoted Anderson, the enfeebled Hill, or the overwrought Ewell, displayed the necessary skill and energy to act in Lee's place. The day's action would be defined only by sharp skirmishing on the Confederate right, and a foolish and unauthorized brigade-sized assault against Lee's left, led by a drunken brigadier named James H. Ledlie. Soon enough, Grant realized the predicament Lee had created and moved quickly to escape the peril. Action along the North Anna would not demand a butcher's bill commensurate with those paid at the Wilderness and Spotsylvania, but the combat continued sporadically and indecisively for another 48 hours. Adding 2,000 names to Confederate casualty rolls and about 2,500 to the Federals. Some of those losses had been made good by accretions to both armies. During the Spotsylvania operations, Grant had called on Halleck to send all the infantry you can rake and scrape. With the present position of the armies, 10,000 troops can be spared from the defenses of Washington. Most of these men served in heavy artillery regiments, specially trained units that manned the large guns emplaced in the forts surrounding the capital. Thousands of these bandbox soldiers tramped into the infantry ranks at Spotsylvania, completely ignorant of battlefield tactics, where they received a rude, albeit successful, introduction to combat, particularly on May 19th near the Harris Farm east of Spotsylvania Courthouse. On the Confederate side of the ledger, some 2,600 of Breckinridge's men from the Shenandoah Valley joined Lee at the North Anna. Breckinridge had defeated the Union thrust up the Shenandoah Valley at New Market on May 15th. Once that incursion had been vanquished, he boarded cars on the Virginia Central Railroad and traveled the 100 miles to Hanover Junction, which served as Lee's intermediate supply depot during the Spotsylvania and North Anna operations. At the same time, a reinvigorated George Pickett arrived with his division to rejoin the army from which he had been separated since the previous summer. The Federals still enjoyed numerical superiority, but in roughly the same proportion as 3 weeks earlier. However, events along the North Anna demonstrated that while the Army of Northern Virginia remained a dangerous defensive weapon, its ability to dictate events on the battlefield had been weakened in the bloody woods and fields of Orange and Spotsylvania counties. Grant discerned as much. "Lee's army is really whipped," he told Halleck on May 26th. "The prisoners we now take show it, and the action of his army shows it unmistakably. A battle with them outside of entrenchments cannot be had." Meade agreed as he wrote his wife. "We undoubtedly have the morale over them, and will eventually, I think, compel them to go into Richmond." Assistant Secretary of War Charles A. Dana expressed the most sanguine of these optimistic assessments in his May 26th dispatch to Edwin Stanton. "Rebels have lost all confidence and are already morally defeated. This army has learned to believe that it is sure of victory. Even our officers have ceased to regard Lee as an invincible military genius. Rely upon it, the end is near as well as sure." Lesser personages throughout the army echoed these sentiments. Although events would prove such judgments premature, Grant indisputably maintained the initiative, and, as at the Wilderness and Spotsylvania, planned a movement around Lee's right that would bring him closer to the Confederate capital. "I determined to draw out of our present position and make one more effort to get between him and Richmond," remembered Grant. "I had no expectation now, however, of succeeding in this, but I did expect to hold him far enough west to enable me to reach the James high up." Grant employed substantial selective memory in making this statement, as the campaign's most sanguinary 60 minutes lay 9 days in the future, suggesting that Grant in fact hoped to achieve his goals before reaching the James. The Federals continued their habit of shifting to their left, south and east, aiming this time for the Pamunkey River. Grant chose this route for 2 reasons. First, he would avoid multiple river crossings by spanning the Pamunkey, a stream northeast of Richmond that collected the North Anna, South Anna, and smaller waterways that would course across Grant's route to the southwest. Second, and even more critically, the navigable Pamunkey offered Grant a secure waterborne supply base, a critical determinant for all his movements since crossing the Rapidan. Sheridan had returned from his Richmond raid by this time, so the cavalry would be available to screen the movement and feint toward Lee's left to pin the Confederates in place. The army started after dark on May 26th, and 2 days later the Federals were south of the Pamunkey, negotiating the river at Hanovertown and Nelson's Crossing. In addition to considerations of supply and logistics, an advance across the Pamunkey would allow Grant to utilize the Army of the James, which had been essentially somnolent since Butler's retreat into the Bermuda Hundred fortifications on May 16th. Grant ordered Halleck to dispatch as many of Butler's men as could be spared, consistent with maintaining a viable defense at Bermuda Hundred and City Point. Baldy Smith would lead these troops, and Butler dispatched two divisions of Smith's 18th Corps, augmented by units from the 10th Corps, to travel by water down the James and up the Pamunkey to join the Army of the Potomac, in the process frustrating Butler's plans to attack Petersburg. Grant's deception froze Lee in place on May 26th. From present indications, he seems to contemplate a movement on our left flank, Lee erroneously reported to the Secretary of War. Soon enough, however, Lee discovered the enemy's true course of action and hastened to shift his divisions to confront Grant south of the Pamunkey. Both commanders dispatched their cavalry to obtain concrete information about their enemy's intentions, resulting in a sharp clash at Hawes' Shop on May 28th. Now aware of Grant's position and general direction, Lee chose to deploy behind a steep-sloped rivulet called Topotomy Creek. His troops erected fortifications and once again blocked the shortest approach to the Confederate capital. They did so, however, without the services of the Second Corps commander. Ewell reported himself so ill with an intestinal malady on the 27th that Lee was compelled to replace him with Early. Although a few days later Ewell would pronounce himself well enough to return to active duty, Lee would reassign him to command the Department of Richmond, where he would serve for the next 10 months. Longstreet was wounded, Ewell incapacitated, Stuart dead, and Hill periodically prostrate. The campaign had been hard on the Army of Northern Virginia's high command. The armies sparred across Topotomy Creek on May 29th. The next day, Lee ordered Early to test the Federal left flank near a country meeting house called Bethesda Church. Old Jube's first action as Second Corps commander earned him low marks. His assaults proceeded without adequate reconnaissance or coordination with other forces, and the Federals easily repulsed him. During the day, various reports indicated that substantial reinforcements were steaming toward Grant's army. Lee deduced that the road network, converging at an intersection known as Old Cold Harbor, would likely attract the attention of these Federals, as highways there led straight toward Richmond, a dozen miles to the west. Lee ordered a cavalry division to hold this key location until fresh troops, Major General Robert F. Hoke's division, pried away from a reluctant Beauregard, could arrive from south of the James. This time, Lee's analysis proved accurate. Grant told Sheridan to occupy Old Cold Harbor until Smith's arrival, while the rest of the army shifted to the south. The unassuming intersection of five roads, which had been the scene of fierce fighting 2 years earlier during the Battle of Gaines Mill, would once again ring with furious combat. After some confusion, Sheridan solidified his occupation of Old Cold Harbor on June 1st. Wright's Sixth Corps was en route to bolster the cavalry, and Smith would have already appeared had inexplicably incompetent staff work not misdirected him from the Army's developing supply depot at White House Landing on the Pamunkey. Until the infantry arrived, Sheridan would have to dismount his troopers and defend Cold Harbor alone. Lee had also arranged for a concentration at Old Cold Harbor. In addition to Major General Fitzhugh Lee's cavalry division and Hoke's four brigades of veteran foot soldiers, Major General Joseph Kershaw's division of the First Corps would sidle down from the north and complement Hoke's approach from the west. As it turned out, the Confederate assaults were even more wretched than those that had failed at Bethesda Church 2 days earlier. Kershaw's lead brigade went into battle under an untested commander who marched his men into the heart of the Federal resistance. This assault failed within 5 minutes. None of the rest of Kershaw's troops tested Sheridan's mettle, and Hoke's men remained strangely unengaged. The Sixth Corps began to arrive at 10 a.m., and with them the immediate danger to Old Cold Harbor passed. Smith's exhausted men eventually turned up while Grant had the entire Army of the Potomac sidestepping south. The Confederates spent the rest of the day constructing earthworks west of the road intersection, carelessly leaving a 350-yard gap between Hoke's and Kershaw's divisions. A brigade of the 6th Corps struck that weak point when elements of Wright's and Smith's commands launched a large-scale assault about 5 p.m. For a few moments, the Federals found themselves behind Confederate lines, but determined counterattacks, abetted by tepid Federal pressure elsewhere, restored the rebel position by dark. Federal casualties piled up, and clearly the Unionists had squandered a golden opportunity to drive Lee's vanguard into the interior Richmond defenses. Grant regretted the lost opportunity and ordered Hancock to march overnight to Cold Harbor and renew the assaults the next morning, before Lee had the chance to perfect his defenses. The night was so dark, the heat and dust so excessive, and the roads so intricate and hard to keep, wrote Grant, that Hancock did not arrive until after dawn. Grant postponed the assault until 1:30 p.m., and then until 5 p.m., but still the Second Corps seemed too spent to mount an attack. Citing the heat and want of energy among the men from moving during the night, Grant reluctantly rescheduled the oft-deferred offensive for dawn, June 3rd. Lee had improved the time by emplacing his army along a 7-mile line, anchoring his right firmly on the swampy margins of the Chickahominy River to the south. Artillery bristled from the raw dirt and fresh-cut logs that popped up along the Confederate front, but even with the additions of Breckinridge, Pickett, and Hoke, Lee's ranks were too thin to provide reserves, except in one place near the right end of his line. Fog blanketed the opposing forces at first light on June 3rd. Grant, confident in his army's superior strength and morale, hoped that the 24-hour delay would not cripple his offensive's chances. In this, he would be disastrously disappointed. The assaults evinced little coordination between the various corps, and in fact only Smith and Hancock charged with sufficient determination to reach the Confederate lines. 2 Second Corps divisions tested Breckinridge's defenses, and one of them punched through a salient manned by Virginia infantry and artillery. This breakthrough, as luck would have it, occurred at the only place on Lee's entire line where a reserve force stood poised to repair any damage. That inevitable counterattack repelled the penetration, restoring the integrity of Lee's right. On the 18th Corps' sector, Smith's divisions challenged the 1st Corps' works, which formed a re-entrant angle that promised unwary attackers flank fire as well as resistance from the front. The soldiers from the Army of the James plunged directly into this death trap. "A heavy line of blue was seen emerging from the timber," recalled an Alabama soldier. "On they came until within musket range of General Anderson's front, when a murderous fire was opened by his entire brigade. Then our brigade and the artillery joined in with a right flank fire, causing the front column to hesitate, thus throwing the rear lines forward in a confused mass." One of Wright's 6th Corps brigades also engaged the Confederates, but what Grant had envisioned as a massive, simultaneous assault deteriorated into the charge of only 11 of 51 infantry brigades. Grant suffered 3,500 casualties in about an hour, far fewer than what is popularly described, but bad enough. Perhaps 700 Confederates fell in Lee's most lopsided victory since the Battle of Fredericksburg in December 1862. Confederate artillerist Brigadier General Edward Porter Alexander pronounced the victory as "our last, and perhaps our highest, tide." Serious combat ceased before noon. Grant toured the battle lines, having delegated tactical control of the assaults to Meade, and concluded after consulting with the corps commanders that nothing more could be gained by resuming the attacks. Grant directed Meade to suspend the offensive and hold the ground gained during the spasmodic advance. In keeping with his responsibilities for the entire Virginia theater of operations, the general-in-chief now focused on detaining Lee at Cold Harbor. Doing so would allow the Federal Army in the Shenandoah Valley, now commanded by Major General David Hunter, to deal with the diminished Confederate force in its front, then march over the Blue Ridge to approach Richmond from the west. Lee's triumph on June 3rd generated relief in Richmond. Such is the confidence of the people in Lee and his noble army that you hear them talking not only of driving the enemy back, but gobbling him up, wrote one resident. The joy derived from such an easy victory was tempered in the Confederate ranks by the horrors of the post-apocalyptic scene that greeted them in the afternoon. The spectacle in front of our line was simply sickening, shuddered a Virginia cannoneer. The horrible heaps of dead lay so ghastly and the wounded were so thickly strewn all over the field. Private David Holt of the 16th Mississippi pitied the dead and dying Yankees and wished that they had had sense enough to stay at home. That night the graves of those who had been killed 2 years earlier at the Battle of Gaines Mill shone, claimed Holt, with a phosphorescent light most spooky and weird, while on the surface of the ground, above the ghastly, shimmering dead, lay thousands of dead that could not be buried. The early summer heat bloated corpses and filled the air with a nauseating miasma. Lee dispatched a report to James Seddon that night, informing the Secretary of War, "Our loss today has been small, and our success, under the blessing of God, all that we could expect." Sporadic and indecisive combat along the lines raised the casualty toll in the Army of Northern Virginia to about 1,500 on June 3rd. Grant's losses approached 7,000 all day. Casualties between May 26th, when the armies disengaged at the North Anna, and June 2nd had numbered about 5,000 each. The human toll since the Federals crossed the Rapidan had been enormous. Northern losses exceeded 50,000 men, while more than 30,000 of Lee's soldiers were killed, wounded, or missing. These figures suggest that the overland campaign deprived the opponents of manpower in about equal proportions. Lee's diminished ability to assume the tactical initiative on the battlefield had been amply demonstrated during the second half of the campaign, and Grant's would be evident shortly. Many of the wounded perished because military protocol stood in the way of compassion. Union troops had, according to General Humphreys, made extraordinary efforts by night to recover the wounded after sunset, but untold numbers remained baking in the summer sun beside the rotting dead. Hancock approached Meade on June 5th, inquiring if something could not be done to relieve the suffering of these maimed wretches. Meade wrote Grant that afternoon explaining that, because the Confederates did not recognize me as in command whilst you were present, the general-in-chief would have to make the request. Grant dutifully addressed a note to General Lee acknowledging the presence of the suffering wounded from both armies between the lines, and citing humanity as the rationale for some provision to be made to provide against such hardships. Grant suggested that during lulls in the skirmishing that had been pervasive since the termination of concerted Union assaults, either party would be authorized to send to any point between the pickets or skirmish lines unarmed men bearing litters to pick up their dead or wounded without being fired upon by either party. Lee replied that this awkward and ambiguous arrangement bore potential for misunderstanding and difficulty, and proposed that a flag of truce be sent between the lines to facilitate succor by either army. Another night passed, and more men perished in agony. Grant received Lee's reply on June 6th and suggested that both armies collect their dead and wounded between noon and 3 p.m. that afternoon. Lee callously, if with technical propriety, noted that Grant had failed to ask specifically for a flag of truce, which in military usage connoted admission of defeat, and so declined to accept Grant's proposal. The frustrated Federal commander replied with a formal request for suspension of hostilities, but more time passed in the transmission of these messages. Lee at last agreed to these terms and wrote at 7 p.m. that the Federals might retrieve their dead and wounded between 8 p.m. and 10 p.m. that night. But this message arrived at Grant's headquarters after the designated time had expired. Not until another exchange of letters on June 7th did the commanding generals settle on a truce between 6 p.m. and 8 p.m. that evening, more than 100 hours after the casualties had been inflicted. Predictably, there were few wounded left for the surgeons, but much more work for the burial details. Meanwhile, Grant had reached a momentous conclusion that would define the war in Virginia for the next and final 10 months. Lee's reliance on maintaining the defensive behind earthworks and the limited real estate available to accommodate another shift around Lee's right, much of it dominated by the swamps of the Chickahominy lowlands, compelled Grant to attempt a crossing of the mighty James River. "My idea from the start has been to beat Lee's army, if possible, north of Richmond. Then, after destroying his lines of communication north of the James River, to transfer the army to the south side and besiege Lee in Richmond, or follow him south if he should retreat," Grant reminded Halleck on June 5th. "Without a greater sacrifice of human life than I am willing to make, all cannot be accomplished that I had designated outside of the city." Grant understood that this scheme involved great peril. The federal Leviathan must secretly disengage from the Army of Northern Virginia, which in most places lay within conversational range of Union front lines. Men, horses, wagons, and other vehicles would have to traverse some 50 miles of roads sufficiently removed from the Cold Harbor works to be beyond Confederate eyes and ears, cross the bridgeless Chickahominy, and span the imposing tidal James, all before Lee could react. If the enemy detected his true intentions, they might attack him astride either river, move against Butler via interior lines before Grant could reinforce the Army of the James, or even shift west and pounce on Hunter as that officer and his small army approached the rail junction at Lynchburg. In order to obviate that final possibility, Grant ordered Sheridan, with two of his three cavalry divisions, to execute a sweeping movement northwest, targeting the Virginia Central Railroad, Lee's link from Richmond to the Shenandoah Valley. He also directed Hunter to cross the mountains, destroy the railroad and canal system at Lynchburg and beyond, and unite with Sheridan, with whom he would eventually join Meade. Doing this would eliminate Lee's communications to the west and force the Confederates to rely solely on the rail lines to the south to maintain their armies and a large civilian population. The destruction of these arteries, the Petersburg, South Side, and Richmond and Danville railroads, would be the ultimate object of Grant's movement to South Side, Virginia. Sheridan left on June 7th. Several days earlier, Hunter had defeated a small Confederate army at Piedmont in the upper Shenandoah Valley, and then seized the important city of Stanton on the Virginia Central Railroad. Lee responded to that setback by returning Breckinridge and his 2,100 infantry to the west to counter Hunter's threat on either side of the Blue Ridge as circumstances dictated. Lee quickly learned of Sheridan's departure, divined his intentions, and dispatched 4,700 troopers under Major Generals Wade Hampton and Fitzhugh Lee in the direction of Hanover Junction and thence along the Central Railroad, keeping the enemy on their right and shaping their course according to his. This left only Major General William Henry Fitzhugh Rooney Lee's small division of horsemen and a cavalry brigade of the Richmond garrison under Colonel Martin W. Gary to provide Lee reconnaissance. This paucity of enemy cavalry would aid Grant's clandestine withdrawal. While Sheridan and Hunter worked their way toward a rendezvous along the Virginia Central Railroad, Grant began the complex preliminaries for his movement to the James. He took steps, ranging from ordering Meade to erect fortifications to cover the army's departure, to directing railroad iron to be removed from the Richmond and York River line and placed on boats to be shipped to City Point or Washington. Grant arranged for troops arriving from the north at White House Landing to be held for transfer to City Point. Most importantly, he set in motion the search for an appropriate crossing point on the James and ordered the proper engineering materials to be available to erect a temporary bridge. He also requisitioned 6 or more ferry boats of the largest class as either a supplement to or replacement for a bridge crossing. In the midst of all these logistical and operational activities, Butler made his aborted attack on Petersburg on June 9th. Although Beauregard saw the portents of an ominous initiative in the action that day, Lee declined to consider Butler's spasm as anything more than a failed reconnaissance, conducted exclusively by the Army of the James. "No troops have left General Grant's army," Lee reassured the nervous Creole. and none could have crossed James River without being perceived. I think it very improbable under present circumstances that Grant would diminish his forces. Still, Lee shifted two brigades, those of Brigadier Generals Matthew Ransom and Archibald Gracie, to the pontoon crossing at Drury's Bluff, about midway between Richmond and Petersburg, in better position to reinforce Beauregard should circumstances so require. Lee was not insensible to the very real possibility that Grant might shift the campaign to the south side of the James. Beauregard certainly thought as much, and many in Richmond believed it as an article of faith. But Lee could not be so sure. Grant might still hammer him from the Cold Harbor lines, or move south of the Chickahominy and approach Richmond between that stream and the James, as the Army of the Potomac had done in 1862. In conjunction with Butler, Grant might also simultaneously menace Richmond from both sides of the James. The protection of Richmond was simply too critical to gamble that Grant would undertake the only one of his many options that would require Lee to remove troops from the capital's defense. Three events on June 11th would have profound effects on military affairs. First, Hampton and Fitz Lee intercepted Sheridan along the Virginia Central Railroad at Trevilian Station in Louisa County. The swirling battle extended into the following day, involving some 12,500 troopers, making it one of the largest cavalry engagements of the entire Civil War. Although the Confederates suffered 1,000 casualties compared to fewer than 800 for Sheridan, the Union commander had little choice but to abandon his mission of destroying the railroad and combining forces with Hunter. Hampton, more than Fitz Lee, performed admirably in command, which boded well for the South Carolinians' future career. General Hunter, known pejoratively as Black Dave, justified his reputation by entering Lexington on June 11th and promptly putting the torch to the Virginia Military Institute barracks, the home of former Virginia Governor John Letcher, and many lesser structures. Hunter's victory at Piedmont, occupation of Stanton, and destruction of Lexington suggested that his only remaining course of action, now that the Shenandoah Valley had been placed at his total mercy, was to move east over the Blue Ridge, probably toward Lynchburg. Actuated by the same motive that prompted him to dispatch Breckinridge, Lee opted to deal decisively with Hunter. Finding that it would be necessary to detach some troops to repel the force under General Hunter, I resolved to send one that would be adequate to accomplish that purpose, and if possible, strike a decisive blow, Lee explained. That blow would entail the defeat of Hunter, followed by a march down the Shenandoah Valley and across the Potomac River. It was hoped that by threatening Washington and Baltimore, General Grant would be compelled to either weaken himself so much for their protection as to afford us an opportunity to attack him, or that he might be induced to attack us. Orders reached Jubal Early on June 12th to prepare to move, and the next day the Second Corps, reduced to 8,000 veteran muskets, headed west. Combined with his earlier detachment of Breckinridge, Lee had now diminished his infantry by 25% from its post-Cold Harbor strength. Lee ultimately thought the potential gains were worth the risks, and events would prove him right. Early's campaigns against Hunter in Lynchburg and subsequently in the Shenandoah Valley, Maryland, Pennsylvania, and the District of Columbia would vex federal authorities for the next 4 months. While Sheridan, Hampton, and Fitz Lee traded saber blows, and Hunter made war on Virginia civilians, Grant communicated with Butler and Meade. The army would move the next day, June 12th, while the 18th Corps returned to Butler via the same rivers that had brought it north. Meade would see to the disengagement of his four infantry corps from the lines at Cold Harbor. The target would be Petersburg, railroad nexus, supply center, and the logistical key to Lee's survival, assuming Hunter and Sheridan could render the Virginia Central Railroad useless. The capture of Petersburg would leave but one railroad in the hands of the Confederates, wrote General Humphreys. And at that moment, Petersburg was ripe for the taking. The contest, according to one Union soldier, would be a campaign of giants. Grant's new target had overlooked the south bank of the Appomattox River for more than 200 years. Petersburg's origins dated to 1645, when English authorities established a frontier military post called Fort Henry on the fall line of the Appomattox. One of the installation's commanders, Major Peter Jones, created a trading center in the neighborhood to carry on peaceful commerce with the occasionally troublesome native population. Jones lent his Christian name to the village that grew up around his establishment. By 1784, two other little settlements, Pocahontas and Blandford, merged with Petersburg to form an incorporated town. Petersburg gained status as a city in March 1850, and according to the 1860 census, the community on the Appomattox had grown to be the second largest city in the Commonwealth of Virginia, numbering 18,266 souls. Petersburg could boast of a distinguished military heritage. On April 25, 1781, a British army, 2,500 strong, approached the town, intent on destroying tobacco and seizing public stores. A makeshift force of about 1,000 Virginia militia offered valiant resistance before retreating safely across the Appomattox, destroying the bridge and preventing pursuit. During the War of 1812, the Petersburg Volunteers, a militia company of about 103 local men, fought bravely in the Old Northwest, particularly at Fort Meigs near what is now Toledo, Ohio. The Virginians went into battle with flashy cockades on their headgear, and when a grateful President James Madison reviewed these veterans, he pronounced their hometown the Cockade City of the Union. The name stuck. Petersburg's growth and prosperity relied on its transportation assets. Poised at the head of navigation on the tidal Appomattox, Petersburg served as a busy port. The federal government erected a handsome new customs house on Union Street in 1858 in recognition of the city's flourishing commerce. The Upper Appomattox Canal penetrated Petersburg's upriver hinterlands and provided reliable waterborne shipping for some 50 miles upstream. A large turning basin on the western margin of town accommodated numerous bateaux that floated myriad varieties of commodities, but especially tobacco, for shipment or processing in Petersburg. By the third decade of the 19th century, railroads began to compete with canals and rivers in America as the most favored means of transportation. Petersburg's local governing body, the Common Council, incorporated the Petersburg Railroad in 1830, and 3 years later, trains connected the Cockade City with Weldon, North Carolina, 60 miles to the south. In order to avoid interruptions caused by the constant silting of the ship channel in the lower Appomattox, the City Point Railroad began operation in 1838. This 8-mile line provided a reliable connection between Petersburg and the deep water of the James River. The inconsequential village of City Point, at the scenic confluence of the James and Appomattox, contributed its name to the enterprise. About the same time, rails connected Petersburg to Richmond. Then, in the mid-1850s, the South Side Railroad began operations to Lynchburg, 124 miles west of the Cockade City. Petersburg viewed the last of its five antebellum railroads, the Norfolk and Petersburg Line, with mixed emotions. The local business community considered Norfolk a commercial rival and feared that once the Iron Horse ran from central Virginia to Hampton Roads, Norfolk would capture business previously belonging to Petersburg. Each of the four trunk lines maintained its own depot, and none of their tracks connected. This ensured that Petersburg hotels, restaurants, and hacks would enjoy a lively business. A number of highways supplemented rails and water, including Jerusalem Plank Road heading southeast and Boydton Plank Road, coursing southwest from the city. Halifax Road paralleled the Petersburg-Weldon Railroad, and Cox Road ran beside the South Side Railroad to the west. In addition to its transportation network, Petersburg enjoyed an exalted status among the manufacturing centers of the South, ranking 49th of all American cities in industrial production in 1860. Tobacco reigned supreme in the Cockade City. Petersburg was the second largest tobacco town in the world, trailing only Richmond. 20 factories sold 23% of the state's tobacco in 1860. Because tobacco processing required no water power, the city's factories tended to locate well south of the riverfront, clustered along Washington Street, the main east-west artery through town, and a handful of cross streets. Rising 2 and 3 stories, and built of brick, the tobacco factories resembled tidy apartment buildings. Workers enjoyed running water fed by reservoirs on the south end of town, central heat, and gas lighting supplied by the municipal gas works on Lombard Street, although no one could argue that labor in these facilities was anything but arduous. Tobacco that arrived on wagons, in bateaux, or by rail was stored awaiting final disposition in one of several official tobacco warehouses. Tobacco dominated the local business community, but Petersburg sustained 3 other vibrant industries. The area's surprisingly mild climate marked it as the northernmost American city to both grow and process cotton. 4 cotton mills operated in or near Petersburg on the eve of the Civil War, 3 of which were run by local businessmen Benjamin Lynch and David Callender. They depended on the water power generated by a system of dams and canals on the Appomattox River, which fell 100 feet in the 5 miles above the fall line. 2 of the factories were located just west of the city on the river's left bank, surrounded by the little mill villages of Matoaka and Ettrick. Approximately 1/3 of Virginia's cotton processing occurred in Petersburg. 3 flour mills, also driven by water power, lined the riverfront. The city also counted 5 iron foundries that forged everything from steam engine parts to ornamental decorations. 1/3 of the state's iron production came from Petersburg, and only Richmond outstripped it in the production of flour. Iron workers earned the highest salaries among Petersburg's laboring class, followed by the millers and the cotton operatives. African Americans, both enslaved and free, dominated the workforce in tobacco factories. Petersburg had always enjoyed a large free black population, and by the outbreak of the Civil War, some of Petersburg's African Americans led a relatively comfortable lifestyle. In 1860, 3,244 of the 8,924 blacks in Petersburg were free, amounting to 26% of the city's entire free population, and the highest such proportion in any southern city. In spite of laws that made manumission difficult and discouraged the relocation of free blacks to Petersburg, their community continued to grow and thrive throughout the 1850s. Free black men and women found employment in the tobacco factories, some men toiled in the iron foundries, and others worked as blacksmiths, coopers, wheelwrights, and brick masons. African Americans operated boats on the Appomattox River and drove hacks and drays, transporting goods and passengers to and from the railroad depots. Vibrant cultural institutions served free blacks in Petersburg, including the Beneficial Society of Freemen of Color, the Petersburg African Church, and Gilfield Baptist Church. About 1 in 3 free black families owned real estate, and a handful owned slaves. Slaveholding in Petersburg followed typical urban patterns. White families and businesses held slaves, who either served as domestics or labored in the tobacco factories. Most Petersburg slaveholders owned just 1 or 2 enslaved people. Nearby farmers and planters controlled a much larger proportion of the local slave population. But as agriculture in the area evolved from a monolithic tobacco culture to mixed production, including grain crops that required a smaller labor force, owners leased their slaves to Petersburg industries or sold them at great profit to planters in the cotton states. Nearly 9 out of 10 white Petersburg residents owned no real property, suggesting that a relatively small number of prosperous families amassed most of the city's wealth. Commission merchants led the list of the Petersburg well-to-do, but they were joined by business owners, railroad officials, and professionals. These men sent their children to one of about 2 dozen private schools in the city, attended lectures at the elegant Library Hall, enjoyed dramatic and musical performances at expansive Phoenix Hall, and indulged a passion for horse racing at the Newmarket Track east of town. A variety of daily and weekly newspapers appealed to nearly all viewpoints on the political spectrum. Beautiful homes lined High Street and South Market Street and surrounded the city's municipal park, Poplar Lawn. The Petersburg elite attended St. Paul's Episcopal Church, or Tab Street Presbyterian, as most of the white population claimed English or Scots heritage. Methodists, Baptists, Catholics, and Jews patronized their own houses of worship. Petersburg politics mirrored those of other southern commercial cities. Although heightened sectional tensions in the late 1850s stimulated enlistment in militia units, as it did across Virginia, Petersburg voters did not embrace the fire-eating sentiments of its most famous secession advocates, agriculturalist Edmund Ruffin and newspaper editor Roger A. Pryor. Most residents favored the constitutional unionist candidate, John Bell, in the 1860 presidential canvass, and sent 58-year-old Thomas Branch to the state convention in February 1861 on a pro-union platform. Branch accepted the legality of secession, but rejected the argument that the election of Abraham Lincoln alone justified leaving the Union. "I was elected on a moderate platform. I am now a moderate man. And whilst I go against coercion, still I feel it to be the duty of Virginia to cling to the Union as long as she can," Branch explained on the floor of the convention. The firing on Fort Sumter in Charleston Harbor in April 1861, and President Lincoln's subsequent call for a quota of militia from each state to suppress the rebellion, changed the political calculus in the state convention, and in Petersburg. Branch voted with the majority on April 17th to take Virginia out of the Union, making Petersburg the seventh largest city in the Confederate States of America. The white population in Petersburg celebrated as robustly as anyone in the emerging nation. Six companies of Petersburg militia boarded trains for the seat of war. New volunteers rushed to join the army. A substantial number of the free black men of military age enthusiastically expressed their desire to serve the Confederacy, either as soldiers or laborers. "We are willing to aid Virginia's cause to the utmost extent of our ability," intoned Charles Tinsley, a bricklayer and spokesman for more than 300 African Americans who gathered on Petersburg's courthouse steps on April 25th. Although Virginia was not about to arm black men, the state welcomed the volunteers as laborers, and the city provided them with a patriotic send-off as they boarded trains for Norfolk. Within 3 months, Petersburg contributed 10 companies of infantry, 2 companies of cavalry, and 3 artillery batteries to the Confederate cause. These 1,200 men represented some 53% of the city's white, military-aged males. Beginning on April 24, 1861, and continuing without respite for more than 4 years, Petersburg played host to visiting soldiers. A South Carolina infantry regiment was the first to arrive in the cockade city. En route from its muster to join the gathering Confederate army in Richmond and Northern Virginia, local residents opened their doors, their purses, and their hearts to these dashing allies from the Deep South. The novelty of arriving soldiers ran its course soon enough, and the informal charity of residents gave way to established institutions to serve the needs of troops in transit. A soldiers' shelter sprang up at Poplar Lawn to accommodate the 1,500 Confederate troops who daily passed through Petersburg on their way north. Restaurants, saloons, and other businesses that catered to the needs of the flesh did a rousing business. Pressure from General Lee in Richmond during the summer of 1861 resulted in the temporary interconnection of the city's through-rail lines, although the Common Council made clear its intention to dismantle those links once military matters no longer required them. Domestic life in Petersburg changed drastically during the first year of the war, but not until the summer of 1862 did the specter of Union occupation loom over the cockade city. While George McClellan's army menaced Richmond from the east, the Federal Navy moved against Petersburg. Commander John Rogers led a flotilla of 10 vessels up the Appomattox River, including the ironclad Monitor, intent on destroying the bridges across the river that had facilitated the rapid reinforcement of Lee's Richmond defenders. On the night of June 26th, Rogers learned the perils of navigating the Appomattox at low tide. 2 of his ships, the Port Royal and the Island Belle, ran aground in the shallow channel, while Confederate shore batteries pounded the fleet. Eventually, Rogers freed his flagship, but he had to strip the island belle and abandon her, along with his effort to reach Petersburg. A few days later, Lee completed his offensive against McClellan by driving the Union commander into a fortified camp along the James River. McClellan expressed the desire to continue his campaign against the Confederate capital by ferrying his men across the James, seizing Petersburg, and entrenching there, forcing Lee to defend his southern communications. Little Mac's credibility in Washington had eroded so badly, however, that Halleck, the new general-in-chief, refused to allow McClellan to execute this plan. As in May 1864, Petersburg escaped certain capture due solely to the whims of Union strategic decisions. Petersburg's local commander, Major General Daniel Harvey Hill, unleashed an artillery attack against the Union camps on August 1st from Coggins Point on the south bank of the James. Old Edmund Ruffin received permission to pull the first lanyard. 41 Confederate cannon erupted shortly after midnight. "A sound," wrote one enthralled witness, "whose grandeur and power words cannot describe, and which cannot be imagined by anyone who has never heard the like, shaking the very ground, and rolling, echoing, and re-echoing through the woods and ravines on the river bank." Startled Union tars rushed to their gun positions and returned fire. After expending about 1,000 rounds and killing or wounding 22 Federals, Hill's forces ceased fire, removed their guns, and returned to Petersburg. Although this assault only irritated the Federals, later that month McClellan's army returned to northern Virginia. McClellan's proximity also spurred Hill to begin to fortify Petersburg. In March 1862, the Common Council had appointed a committee to inquire as to the propriety of putting the city in a state of defense and report what, if anything, is necessary for that purpose. This initiative aided the preparation of the shore defenses along the Appomattox that turned back the Union Navy in June, but virtually nothing had been accomplished that would thwart an approach overland from the east, south, or west. Hill gathered several regiments, first the 48th North Carolina and then the 30th Virginia and the 2nd, 27th, and 46th North Carolina, at the Charles Friend Farm east of the city, and ordered them to begin digging fortifications. He also impressed the labor of local slaves, causing no little distress to their masters. Lee then dispatched a skilled engineer officer to Petersburg, Lieutenant Colonel Walter H. Stevens, to assist Hill in laying out a professional defensive network for the cockade city. Colonel Jeremy F. Gilmer, Lee's chief engineer, also contributed his talents. Stevens and Gilmer delegated responsibility for overseeing their plan to a young engineer officer, Captain Charles H. Dimmock. Dimmock had been in town since May and had superintended construction of the works along the river. His new task would be enormous. Stevens and Gilmer had designed a 10-mile line south of the Appomattox River, consisting of 55 artillery batteries anchored on that river at both ends and numbered consecutively from the downstream fort around the east, south, and west sides of Petersburg. These redans, open in the rear, would mount various numbers of guns depending on their location, the strongest batteries located adjacent to the roads and railroads that entered town. Infantry curtains would connect each of these emplacements. Dimmock went to work using a combination of soldiers and slaves from as far away as North Carolina and Virginia's eastern shore. He made considerable progress, but when McClellan's threat evaporated and the war shifted back to northern Virginia, the number of troops available for fatigue details diminished accordingly. Dimmock kept blacks at work on the line that soon bore his name, but progress languished due to a chronic labor shortage. Hill's successor in Petersburg, Major General Samuel G. French, addressed the Petersburg Common Council on December 12, 1862, complaining about the city's lack of active cooperation in securing civilian workers to complete the Dimmock Line, which ended then at Jerusalem Plank Road. "The early completion of the defensive works around your city must be a matter of paramount interest to yourselves," French implored the local lawmakers. "It has been found impossible to secure an immediate and adequate force to meet the demands for labor." French called on the council to provide a gang of 200 African-American workers to toil from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. each day. With this force for 2 or 3 weeks, more could be accomplished than in as many months of the rapidly approaching bad weather. Municipal leaders heeded French's plea and advertised for slaves and free blacks to work on the defenses for $2 per day, with rations provided by the Confederate government. No laborer would be detained on the trenches more than 20 days, and all would work until 4 p.m., when they would be released to return home. Samuel Lecture, a builder and member of the Common Council, would supervise the workers. Despite these relatively lenient conditions, construction of the Dimmock Line would continue well into 1863, before the trenches and batteries stretched unbroken to the river upstream from town. In the meantime, Confederate authorities turned Petersburg into one of the South's largest military hospital centers. Wounded soldiers began arriving in Petersburg following the fighting at Manassas Junction in July 1861. The Common Council turned exhibition buildings at the city fairgrounds into hospital wards, local hotels opened their doors, and citizens offered their own dwellings as temporary expedients. By August, the Confederate government assumed responsibility for medical facilities in town. Soon the fairgrounds hospital boasted new structures built specifically to house 30 to 40 patients each. The Cameron Tobacco Factory, left idle by its inability to ship its products to a dwindling domestic market, breathed new life as the North Carolina Hospital, run by authorities from the Old North State. Soon other tobacco factories underwent similar transformations, often with the aim of treating patients from specific states. The Ladies' Hospital at 2nd and Bolingbrook Streets operated by private subscription under the leadership of Miss Nora F. Davidson. By July 1862, 7 substantial military hospitals functioned in town. These modern and efficient operations treated nearly 2,500 of Lee's casualties from the 7 days' battles around Richmond. In addition to medical facilities, the Confederate government established a powder mill, lead works, copper and zinc factories for the production of percussion caps, and a naval rope walk in Petersburg. Some 24 slaves tended niter beds to produce potassium nitrate for making gunpowder. Petersburg never became a prison center, although thousands of Union captives traveled through town on their way south, and from time to time Confederate authorities held Union prisoners in warehouses or on islands in the Appomattox River for a day or two. A large number of paroled Confederate prisoners were, however, detained west of town at the model farm awaiting exchange. The twin scourges of rampant monetary inflation and severe shortages of most necessities and all luxuries sorely complicated life for Petersburg residents during the first 3 years of the war. The arrival of Butler's army in early May 1864 brought even harsher times for the city's remaining population, which by then was heavily burdened with poor, elderly and women refugees from Prince George and Chesterfield counties, who had fled to the city before the Union advance. Butler's imminent threat inspired bravado and genuine determination to defy the Yankee invaders. "Better to subsist on dry bread than be ruled by the most detestable race of human beings that ever libeled humanity," declared Petersburg's medical director, Dr. John H. Claiborne. "I have never seen so much enthusiasm amongst the troops as now. There is no way to whip them but to kill them all." Beauregard's victory at Drury's Bluff on May 16th, Butler's retreat behind his Bermuda Hundred defenses, and the transfer of Smith's corps to Cold Harbor tempered the crisis atmosphere in the cockade city. Soon enough, the attack on June 9th reminded city residents that they faced war at our own doors. Hoke's departure left Beauregard with a paper-thin defense, stretching from Drury's Bluff across the Appomattox and ending at Jerusalem Plank Road. "Grant doubtless intends operations against Richmond along the James River, probably on the south side," warned Beauregard on June 7th. "Petersburg, being nearly defenseless, would be captured before it could be reinforced." Along the Union lines at Cold Harbor, that is exactly what Ulysses S. Grant had in mind. 2. Our hearts were filled with new hope. Movement to combat. Targeting Petersburg seemed logical to both Union and Confederate strategists. A brilliant and distinguished graduate of West Point put his finger on the map at Petersburg and said, "There is Richmond," remembered General William F. Smith. The more the map of Virginia and the campaigns in Virginia are studied, the brighter will the truth of that remark shine out. A Southern officer agreed. If Petersburg were captured, Richmond could no longer be held, more than a few days at the utmost. Although Grant's June 5th message to Halleck stated that a movement against Petersburg constituted part of his original campaign plan, historian Brian Holden Reed persuasively argues that there is perhaps a degree of retrospective justification in Grant's assertion. Clearly, Grant's persistent offensives from the Wilderness to Cold Harbor bespoke ambition for decisive results, and as historian T. Harry Williams writes, he was at the end of the line he had said he would fight it out on if it took all summer. His plan had failed. Grant's new course would suspend attempts to reach Richmond through maneuver or by destroying the Army of Northern Virginia in battle. Instead, he would concentrate on severing Lee's supply lines from the south and west. In conjunction with Philip Sheridan's and David Hunter's strikes against the Virginia Central Railroad and James River Canal, Grant's shift across the James might compel Lee to forsake his fortifications and come out to fight for his communications. That could lead to the ultimate showdown on open ground that Grant had failed to achieve throughout the spring. Whether or not the shift against Petersburg had been integral to Grant's original strategy, the effort would require substantial planning beyond whatever conceptual framework the Union commander had previously developed. In addition to the conundrum of how to transport his army to Southside Virginia, Grant worried about Benjamin Butler's security during the operation, and about the potential threat posed by the small Confederate navy poised on the James below Richmond. Still, the overarching challenge remained how and where to cross that imposing tidal river swiftly and secretly. The mighty James is navigable for more than 108 miles from its mouth at Hampton Roads to the fall line at Richmond. Federals, such as Brigadier General Alfred H. Terry, thought the James majestic. Such an enormous mass of water is it that it seems a ponderous flood. From the Virginia capital downstream for 20 miles, the James is relatively narrow and difficult to navigate with an average depth of 7 feet. But below the mouth of the Appomattox at City Point, the river widens substantially to between 1,000 and 4,000 yards, except at a few select spots. The narrows between Old Fort Powhatan on the south bank and the Wayanoke Peninsula to the north, 34 river miles below Richmond and 14 miles downriver from City Point, is the first such location. The channel here was more than 80 feet deep and had a tidal fluctuation of about 4 feet with a swift current. Passing an army across such an obstacle in the presence of the enemy would pose a logistical nightmare. Grant's strategy for conquering the James evolved over a week, beginning on June 5th, when he informed Halleck of his intention to move the army to the south side of the James River, either by crossing the Chickahominy and marching near City Point, or by going to the mouth of the Chickahominy on the north side and crossing there. The general-in-chief thought the latter option more promising, which prompted his request for ferry vessels. Halleck responded on the 7th, pledging to provide as many boats of all descriptions as possible from the motley fleet based at Fort Monroe. "Everything will be sent forward as soon as you direct," replied Halleck, who was known in army circles with a mixture of respect and derision as "Old Brains." On the afternoon of June 6th, Grant summoned a senior aide, Colonel Cyrus B. Comstock, and his junior colleague, Lieutenant Colonel Horace Porter, to his headquarters tent. Grant's planning had matured overnight, as he informed the staff officers. He had decided to send Smith's corps by a forced night march to Cole's Landing on the Chickahominy, there to take boats and be transferred to Butler's position at Bermuda Hundred. The Army of the Potomac would, by rapid marches, reach the James River and prepare to cross. Comstock and Porter were to explain the contemplated movement fully to General Butler and see that the necessary preparations are made by him to render his position secure against any attack from Lee's forces while the Army of the Potomac is making its movement. A second mission required them to select the best point on the river for the crossing, taking into consideration the necessity of choosing a place which will give the Army of the Potomac as short a line of march as practicable, and which will be far enough downstream to allow for a sufficient distance between it and the present position of Lee's army to prevent the chances of our being attacked successfully while in the act of crossing. Grant emphasized that their recommendations should be guided by considerations of the width of the river at the point of crossing and of the character of the country by which it will have to be approached. Porter and Comstock boarded a steamer at White House Landing the next day, bound for Bermuda 100 via Fort Monroe, which they reached that night. Grant by then had notified Butler of the impending arrival and purpose of his emissaries. Comstock and Porter arrived at Butler's headquarters at 5 p.m. on June 8th. En route, they examined the banks of the James for likely places at which to build a pontoon bridge and identified both the narrows at Fort Powhatan as well as Butler's existing facilities at Bermuda 100. After visiting with Butler and receiving his assurance that once Smith arrived with the 18th Corps he could hold his lines against Lee's entire army, Grant's staffers headed back downriver on June 10th. Leaving Fort Monroe on the 11th, they arrived at White House Landing at 9 p.m., and then made the overland trek back to Grant's Cold Harbor headquarters. They would report their recommendations to the General-in-Chief the following morning. While Grant waited for his aides to return, he busied himself with other issues incident to the withdrawal of his troops. On the evening of June 8th, he directed Meade to construct a defensive line from the present right to left, to be occupied by two divisions of the 5th Corps in order to cover the disengagement of the rest of the army. He assigned Brigadier General John G. Barnard, newly arrived Chief Engineer of the armies in the field, to instruct Meade's Chief Engineer, Major James Duane, on where to locate these works. Duane, described by Meade's staffer, Lieutenant Colonel Lyman, as a railroad-looking man with a long beard, whose clothes would be improved by a brush, used the next 48 hours to complete a line, running almost directly in front of Old Cold Harbor from Elder Swamp northward to Allen's Mill Pond. He finished the work on the morning of June 11th. Although Grant did not formally communicate his final plans to his principal commanders until June 11th, he had discussed them with Meade and anticipated their execution the previous day. In evident response to these briefings, at 7:30 p.m. on June 10th, Meade ordered General Warren to shift the divisions of Brigadier Generals Romaine B. Ayres and Samuel W. Crawford to the south, in preparation for moving his entire corps across the Chickahominy River at Long Bridge, then advancing to the Glendale intersection at Riddle's Shop to assume his blocking position. "The order for the movement of the army will be sent to you in due time," added Meade, admonishing Warren to consider the instructions confidential. Due time proved to be the next day, when Grant explicitly informed both Meade and Butler of his concept for the movement south, which would begin on the evening of June 12th. He admitted that without the report from Comstock and Porter as to the recommended crossing point, he could not provide instructions as definite as I would wish, but that an unspecified timetable dictated that the operation should commence promptly. No doubt Grant anticipated that he would hear from his staff officers shortly, and then identify the Army's precise destination in ample time to make all the necessary arrangements. Grant provided succinct, general guidance to Meade, relying on the Pennsylvanian to sort out the details consistent with Meade's role as Army commander. The 5th Corps would bear responsibility for screening the Army's departure by crossing the Chickahominy at Long Bridge and then marching west on Long Bridge Road, to its junction with the Quaker Road, or until stopped by the enemy. The Army's remaining three corps would follow as Meade determined, one crossing behind Warren at Long Bridge and the other two negotiating the Chickahominy 6 miles downstream at Jones Bridge. The 18th Corps, on loan from the Army of the James, would march to the Army's supply base at White House Landing on the Pamunkey River, board transports, and make its way back to Butler via the York and James Rivers. The wagon trains and artillery of Smith's Corps, along with those of the Army of the Potomac, would follow a separate route, crossing the Chickahominy downstream from Jones Bridge. The general direction of Meade's forces and the trains would be a point on the James opposite Fort Powhatan and near the Shire village of Charles City Courthouse. Meade, with substantial input from his chief of staff, Andrew Humphreys, translated these concepts, and whatever conversations he had with Grant prior to receiving his written instructions on the 11th, into a comprehensive 15-part order addressing each constituent component of his command. The cavalry drew Meade's initial attention. Only James H. Wilson's 3rd Division remained with the Army after Sheridan's departure for the Virginia Central Railroad and his rendezvous with Hunter. Wilson had assigned his 2 brigades to patrol the respective flanks of the infantry line, with the 5 regiments of Colonel George H. Chapman's 2nd Brigade on the left picketing along the Chickahominy. Meade called for Chapman to lead the way across that swampy stream in the vicinity of the ruined Long Bridge, and push westward toward the Glendale intersection, clearing the road for the 5th Corps. Warren's 4 divisions remained divided on the night of June 11th. Ayres and Crawford had shifted south that day to a position several miles north of Long Bridge, in accordance with their orders, while Brigadier General Charles Griffin's 1st Division and Brigadier General Lysander Cutler's 4th Division extended along the northern margins of the Chickahominy lowlands to the northwest, occupying the Army's far left. Meade's orders called for all 4 of Warren's divisions to march after dark on the 12th toward Long Bridge, cross the river in Chapman's wake, and assume a blocking position covering the bridge over White Oak Swamp and the road network that converged at Glendale, both logical routes by which the Confederates could interdict the designated Union corridors. Warren's advance might yield the additional benefit of persuading the Confederates that his men were the vanguard of an offensive aimed directly at Richmond between the James and the Chickahominy, thus buying additional time for the Army to reach the James unhindered. Once the rest of the Army neared that river, Warren was to follow in the footsteps of the 2nd Corps. Hancock would disengage from his position on the southern end of the Cold Harbor defenses and proceed to Long Bridge. From there, the 2nd Corps would make its way toward Charles City Courthouse, just north of the James. The next corps in line, Horatio Wright's 6th, would disengage and occupy Duane's new entrenched line behind Old Cold Harbor, along with Hancock, until their routes were clear of traffic. Wright would then trek toward the Chickahominy and a crossing at the site of Jones Bridge. Ambrose Burnside's 9th Corps, on the Army's far right, would follow different roads east and then south to Jones Bridge and a rendezvous with the 6th Corps about 3 miles north of the Chickahominy. The corps reaching this point first would henceforth take the lead. Smith's 18th Corps would follow a unique course eastward to White House Landing, enjoying the right of way should they cross paths with the 9th Corps en route. At White House, the men would board transports for their journey back to Bermuda 100. A 4th route would lead the Army's wagons, and Smith's artillery and trains, on roads farthest east toward a crossing near the head of navigation on the Chickahominy, called Windsor Shades, 4 miles below Jones Bridge. Brigadier General Edward Ferrero and his 4th Division of the 9th Corps, comprising the Corps' U.S. colored troops, would accompany the wagon train as guards. Colonel John B. McIntosh's brigade of Wilson's Cavalry Division would cover the Army's rear. The bridges at all 3 crossing points had been demolished, so Meade's orders specified how engineer troops would employ canvas and wooden pontoons assigned to the 5th and 6th Corps to construct temporary spans. The orders concluded by directing the Army's base of supplies to be transferred to the James and the existing depot at White House Landing to be dismantled by Hunter and Sheridan when they returned from their forays against the Virginia Central Railroad. Grant's message to Butler informed him both of the arrangements to ferry Smith's Corps back to Bermuda 100 and the general direction of the Army of the Potomac, which would strike the James River at the most practicable crossing below City Point. The general-in-chief assured Butler that Smith would arrive before Lee could possibly mount an attack against the Army of the James, and that Meade would be available not more than one day later. Grant would rely on Butler to accumulate the means to cross the Army of the Potomac, and in the absence of recommendations from Comstock and Porter, authorized him to build a pontoon bridge across the James, somewhere below City Point. Buried oddly within the paragraph authorizing the construction of a pontoon bridge was Grant's permission for Butler to attempt to seize and hold Petersburg if he felt that Smith's arrival gave him enough force to attack the city with a reasonable degree of confidence of success. Despite this apparent afterthought, Grant clearly focused at this time on secretly extricating his army from Cold Harbor, transferring it safely across the James, and ensuring that Butler would not be menaced while the Army of the Potomac was in transit. Detailed plans for coordinated operations in Southside Virginia would, presumably, await a later day. On the morning of June 12th, Comstock and Porter met with Grant and made their recommendation that the army cross near Fort Powhatan. They based their judgment on the narrowness of the river there and the practicability of building approach roads. Porter noticed Grant's unusually nervous manner during their interview, concluding that it was evident that he was wrought up to an intensity of thought and action which he seldom displayed. Grant concluded the meeting by informing his staffers that the army would begin the move that night. In the meantime, Butler's chief engineer, Brigadier General Godfrey Weitzel, dispatched a regular engineer officer, Lieutenant Peter S. Mitchie, to investigate specific crossing points in the vicinity of Fort Powhatan. Mitchie reported that at three places on the Wayanoke Peninsula, a protrusion into the left bank of the James aiming at Fort Powhatan, the river measured less than 2,000 feet across. The shortest two of these points, however, needed extensive work to prepare approaches on the river's north shore. The third location, 1/2 mile upstream from Wayanoke Point at the tip of the peninsula, would require a much shorter corduroy road across the marsh, although access to the south shore here would demand additional preparation. Weitzel apprised Comstock of the results of Mitchie's reconnaissance, but independently decided that the third option, where the river measured 1,992 feet, made the most sense. While waiting for Grant's authorization, Weitzel began preparations for construction of the approaches. Grant approved Weitzel's decision the next afternoon, and work began in earnest. Grant had already dispatched Lieutenant Colonel Frederick Dent, his brother-in-law, to Fort Monroe, and then on to Bermuda Hundred, to see the assemblage of pontoon materials and ferryboats at the proposed crossing point. He reiterated the need for all such vessels and equipment in a message to the 18th Corps' chief quartermaster on June 12th. At the same time, Meade's chief quartermaster, Brigadier General Rufus Ingalls, issued instructions to assemble a fleet at White House Landing for use by Smith's Corps. The operation now contemplated by Grant transcended in difficulty and danger any that he had attempted during the campaign, thought a member of his staff. He was to withdraw an army from within 40 yards of the enemy's line and to march through the difficult swamps of the Chickahominy Bottom to positions where that stream could be crossed without interruption from the rebels, then to advance to the James, a great and tidal river at a point 700 yards across, to effect a passage with all the munitions and supplies of 100,000 soldiers, changing his base from White House to City Point, 150 river miles apart, to effect a combination of Meade's force with that on the James. Edward Porter Alexander considered Grant's plan the most brilliant stroke in all the federal campaigns of the whole war. Bold it was, but it remained to be seen if the Union High Command could execute and then exploit their logistical success to achieve their ultimate goal, control of Petersburg's railroad nexus. "Today we commence a flank march to unite with Butler on the James," Meade informed his wife on June 12th. "If it is successful, as I think it will bring us to the last act of the Richmond drama, and will end fortunately and victoriously for us." The success of the movement depended intrinsically on secrecy. Horace Porter lavished praise on Grant's ability to keep his own counsel, calling him Ulysses the Silent and the Great Unspeakable, providing anecdotal evidence that even officers of exalted rank were unaware of the commander's full intentions. The Fifth Corps artillerist, Colonel Charles Wainwright, expressed a different opinion. "We are bound for the James River, south side," read Wainwright's diary on June 11th. "At least so says rumor, for the information comes tolerably direct, though not through authorized channels." Wainwright complained that, "While every precaution is being taken at the front to prevent the enemy suspecting what is up, the exact point of our destination is freely spoken of by the quartermaster's department, and as a matter of course comes up by every teamster, who tells it to all the men he knows, and officers, even generals of divisions, first learn the plan of campaign through their enlisted men." In an environment where rumors circulated cheaply and with great frequency, however, a distinction remained on both sides of the cold harbor lines between news from the grapevine and credible intelligence. Regardless of their degree of knowledge about the proposed shift to the south, Union soldiers in the lines at Cold Harbor found their current circumstances almost intolerable. A New Jersey chaplain recalled, "The space of ground occupied by the works before Cold Harbor was becoming exceedingly offensive, and there was fear of its breeding infection if the stay was continued much longer. Shallow graves received the dead within our lines, though by scores they lay in full sight for days, bloated and blackened. Dead horses, swelled to bursting, were left where they had been shot down, objects of aversion to sight and smell. We hailed, almost with acclamations, the announcement of our withdrawal from that awful place. No words can adequately describe the horrors of the 12 days we had spent there, and the sufferings we had endured." Those announcements of impending movements, albeit without mention of specific destinations, circulated among the troops at various times on June 12th. The army would disengage after dark to conceal its departure while a skeleton force made a show of continued occupation. Soldiers built a road to expedite the movement of Hancock's corps, and preliminary adjustments proceeded throughout the day out of sight of watchful Confederates. Every man had his tin cup tied fast and his tin plate, if he was rich enough to have one, safely stowed in his haversack, wrote one Federal. So when the movement was begun, there was not a rattle or a jingle to be heard. Although Smith's rear echelon units set off toward White House in the afternoon, the bulk of his three divisions began withdrawing from their positions at Cold Harbor after sunset. Smith assigned Colonel Guy V. Henry, a brigade commander in Brigadier General William T.H. Brooks's division, to organize the corps' departure. Henry's father had been a friend of Smith's in the old army, and the 18th Corps commander considered the 25-year-old Henry an energetic, intelligent, and ambitious officer. The troops of Brigadier General Adelbert Ames's 10th Corps division, serving under Smith since their transfer across the James in late May, led the way about 8 p.m., followed by Brooks's men, and then the division of Brigadier General John H. Martindale. Henry masked their movement by ordering regimental bands to play long and loudly, while keeping about 250 men of the 21st Connecticut and 58th Pennsylvania of his brigade on the picket line, making their presence known to their vigilant Confederate counterparts. Between 2 a.m. and 3 a.m., once the rest of the infantry had moved out, Henry guided these rearguard soldiers out of their lines without detection. Smith's troops had the shortest march to their destination, only 18 miles, but not necessarily the easiest. A huge knot of supply wagons from the Army of the Potomac impeded Smith's progress near Tunstall's station on the Richmond and York River Railroad, and the exhausting pace along roads so dusty as to be almost suffocating tested the soldiers' endurance. The first of Smith's men reached White House Landing in mid-morning June 13th. Smith received instructions from Grant's headquarters to "send forward your troops to Bermuda 100 as fast as they embark without waiting for divisions. the object being to get them to Bermuda Hundred at the earliest possible moment. This was Smith's first hint of the urgency attending the shift back to the James, although the need for that urgency remained unarticulated. He immediately saw to the loading of Brooks's division and told Ames to oversee the embarkation of the rest of the corps, leaving the 10th Corps men the last to depart. Smith then boarded the steamer Metamora for the trip down the Pamunkey and York and up the James. Martindale's division boarded its transports during the afternoon and was underway by 4 p.m. It would be the next morning before all of Ames's men left White House Landing. While Smith marched to White House Landing, Warren and Wilson headed for the Chickahominy. Chapman's cavalry led the way and reached the crossing point at Long Bridge shortly after dark, expecting to find a pontoon bridge already in place. The engineers responsible for constructing the span had been there for some time, but stymied by fire from Confederate sharpshooters on the south bank, they had not yet started their work. The officer in charge of the pontoons, Major George W. Ford of the 50th New York Engineers, seemed somewhat timid, sneered Wilson. The Chickahominy River here, as elsewhere along much of its course, consisted of two narrow channels. At the Long Bridge site, the northern branch measured 100 feet in width and the southern 60 feet, the two divided by an island some 250 feet across. The banks of the river are more swamps containing a black covering of water, which reflects all the foliage and umbrageous covering in images of the somberest nature, wrote Lewis Steiner, an official with the U.S. Sanitary Commission. The soil is a rich muck, which would contribute to the fertilization of the land if it were applied by the enterprising...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.